to my left, and I don't know that I should start singing with a surprise animal in close proximity, particularly this animal. I don't know. Chandra, do you think you could serenade them?
Could.
You think you could?
Do you have any requests?
Do I have any requests? Anything but put a banana in your ear or Charlie the Unicorn. And go. Do you know any other songs? Yes, you do. Yeah, you do. You know the Careless Whisper song that gets into our head once.
I don't know, we're gonna dance.
Yes, exactly.
I don't know the words to that song.
I know, that's because that's why you always go into REM halfway through.
What if we found it?
It's that Meloid thing again. Ah.
Brentford, it was a blister beetle. I did ask him. I found them all over camp. And
they're everywhere. They're not blister beetles, but there are ones that look very similar. So they're Meloids, they're mimics. That there's
aposematic coloration still.
Yes.
Or is it just mimic?
It's mimic aposematic coloring.
What's one called mimic aposematic coloration?
Mimicry. mimicked aposematic coloration.
Absolutely.
I know. Oh, the little shiny thing. Should we show you the shiny thing? It can be part of the pre-show treats, like a pre-show jewel. Oh, but you are such a delicate little creature. Hold on a moment, sorry. Pause and I actually think it might not be alive anymore, Chandra.
Yeah.
I know.
You make me sad, huh?
Sorry. I don't think it's living. It is beautiful, though.
Yes.
It's the most extraordinary vast array of colours. Oh, the sun's disappeared now, Chandra.
Oh.
I think it was the clouds covering over your singing.
No, it's the lack of singing.
It's the lack of singing.
The
anti-cloud song. Oh, actually, sorry, somebody's talking to me on the Game Drive comms, and I've got it so far turned down. Oh, sorry. This is the pre-show chaos, everybody. Somebody was talking to me. Afternoon stations, one station on site with the Mhlati Ingwe from this morning, same position just outside Yuri's house. I know, I just gave away this prize. I'm sorry. Okay. Should we show it? Well, we did. I did give it away now. Wait, I'm trying to... trying to figure out what this... You don't feel right about the giving away the surprise?
No. Well,
you know, I would actually join you in song this afternoon. I feel a song coming on, but I don't know.
In the jungle.
A Disney classic. Nah. Maybe not. Such a fascinating little beetle. Seen them before. Most amazing colours. I can see my reflection in it. Not in great detail, obviously. Isn't that really pretty? We have 1.5 moments to talk freely, Chandra. Freely on any subject. Is that a woodlands? No, it's not a woodlands. In fact, that was a very bad call. That was a buffalo weaver. It's not a woodlands. There was, however, a woodlands in camp just before we went on drive. There was definitely a woodlands, I promise you. It flew in and it flew out, and it's probably somewhere around here. And actually, so is one of the missing members of this crew for our surprise start of show. Hiding somewhere. Maybe she's in Yuri's garden.
If I see a woodlands today, this is what it's going to look like.
If I see a woodlands today, it's going to be blurry safaris. That's of course because Chandra bet that the woodlands would be back tomorrow. They have of course been back for the last 3 days, we just haven't managed to get them on camera. Last two days. You never know, Chandra. What are we going to do if I see one? Am I going to focus the camera myself? Could be entertaining.
Do you want to operate first?
No, I don't think that's a very good idea. For the pre-show, we've got 30 seconds. I can't really mess up that much in 30 seconds. Ooh, it's tempting fate. Look, I've got a new toy to play with. It's James's camera. 15 seconds. Rightio. And as soon as disclaimer starts, we will swing to the surprise. 10, 8, 7, 6, 5... Four. Oh, three. Never mind then.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the wonder that is the African bush. We're in search of everything big and small, from lions to leopards, from elephants to little bugs. This is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Welcome to the Greater Kruger National Park, 8.5 million acres of African wonderland. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Egbert, Eggsy, Zander, boiled egg, poached egg, bald egg on camera with me today. And we're going to take you on a bit of an adventure. So, of course, those of you who were with us for the sunrise safari will know that it was a sunrise safari filled with big cats, lions and leopards. Four different cat sightings this morning. Two Birmingham boys, the Nkuhuma Pride, Karula Cubs and Tingana. So it is about 27 degrees Celsius, 80 Fahrenheit. So it's a bit warm and I think most of those big cats are going to be quite lethargic at this time of the day. So we're going to do something a little bit different. But before I go into detail about what we're going to do, and remember you can ask us questions on the hashtag Safari Bird live on Twitter, or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. It's quite a rare one. We've only seen them twice so far. Well done, Eggs. And it's calling. It is a great spotted cuckoo. And what a wonderful way to start a challenge that I've set for Egbert and myself. Egbert said, did he do something to offend me when I mentioned the challenge? Now, I'm not sure what the greatest number of birds ever seen on one drive is, but we're going to, there he goes, attempt. Oh, there's a female following. An attempt to break that record. And what a wonderful way to start. And there's another one, but I'm going to get it on camera before it flies away, before I keep talking. And there we go. You got him on top there. A very nice, distinct body shape when they stand like that. If he turns his lovely face round, we'll see he's got a really, really deep orange eye. You'll notice that there's no feathers on the legs, and that is a dead giveaway for a member of the snake eagle family, and that is indeed the most common member of the snake eagle family we get here, the brown snake eagle. You can just make out those orange eyes even at this distance. He's quite far away, so that's two already. And also, maths is not my strong point, so you guys are going to have to keep count for me while we see what else we can find. Now, to make it even more entertaining, oh, here are the squirrels. They're very upset that the eagle's there. Not only are we going to attempt to do birds, we are going to attempt to do a few flying creatures as well. One of my favorites, another one that brings a cold sweat to the camera operators, and that is, of course, butterflies or flutterbys, depending on how you look at it. So we're going to try and look at lots of different small things, flying things, crawly things, and I'm very excited for this. I'm very excited for the sunset safari. And then when it gets darker and cooler, I think we might go look for those Birmingham boys. Now, Debbie in Vancouver says she would love to see a woodlands kingfisher today. Debbie, the race is on. Byron, Jamie and myself have all seen woodlands kingfishers today. Byron and VM this morning, but it flew off before they could come to them. We saw one now driving between Inga's house and the DRC, and then one flew through the DRC. So the race is on. Who is going to find the first woodlands? And we're going to try get to at least 40 bird species. We've never got that far. And of course, I'm not the only one out here, but I'm going to be searching everywhere for anything that we can find. And while I carry on the search, Byron is still tromping around, and I'm sure he'd like to say hello. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Bushwalk. On this afternoon on camera is VM with me, and then Herbert obviously around with us again. It's great to be back out this afternoon on our little walk. I've just come up to this termite mound. The reason for that is I actually just want to get a vantage point. Now, we've heard some elephants not too far from us, probably 100, 150 meters or so. We could just hear some branches breaking. So it's nice to sometimes get a nice vantage point and perhaps try and have a look around. So let's do that. Let's scan quickly. Let me just see. And perhaps here, we'll listen out and see if we can hear the elephant. Nothing just yet, but we're going to head in that direction. And now, as Brent was saying, he's in search of some birds and butterflies. We are also going to be searching for birds. I'm not so sure about the butterflies, but definitely little creatures and some little insects. I just heard a spider hunting wasp fly past. I can't see it now. It's flown off. They're very, very quick, but very loud wasps when they do fly past. And he did mention, Brent mentioned about the woodland kingfisher. We saw one this morning. VM spotted it. Unfortunately, it flew off before we could show you. So the race is on to see who can spot the first woodland kingfisher on camera. That's when it counts. So let's hope. Hopefully we'll get a bit lucky this afternoon. I haven't heard any yet this afternoon while we've been out, but you never know. What we're going to do is carry on down and head towards those elephant. Hopefully we can find them. That would be wonderful. I'd love to view some elephant on foot with all of you. That would be something very, very interesting and something different, which I really, really do enjoy. While we make our way through the thicket, let's head over to Jamie so she can say hello to you.
And a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome to the Sunset Safari. Starting off, whilst the other two are focusing on somewhat smaller things, we're starting off with something a little bit larger in the form of the magnificent Queen of Juma in a truly picturesque setting. An absolutely magical place for her to be, resting underneath the shade of an ivy tree. And then, just a little bit further above her, looks like now... Hello, little one. Are we looking at Shungile here, or are we still looking at Hosanna? Need to get a little bit closer. Hello, little girl. That looks like the little girl to me. What a wonderful surprise, because this morning she was missing, of course. She wasn't around at all. But a very good afternoon to all of you. My name is Jamie. This afternoon I have Jandre on camera with you. Those of you who were fortunate enough to bear witness to the pre-show show would, of course, have heard him singing away. And we have the lovely tones of Rebecca and Jerry directing us this afternoon. And what a wonderful way to start. I'm just going to wave hello to yours. And we'll have a look and see if we can figure out exactly where cub number two is resting up. So for those of you that perhaps have joined us for the first time, this is Karula, who is a 12-year-old leopard, and she's known as the Queen of Juma, a title I feel that has been very well earned on the basis that over the last 12 years she has lived in this particular area. And right now I have to tell you, we are 100 meters away from the lodge fence, so we're not far away from the lodge at all. This is one of Karula's favorite spots, or used to be one of Karula's favorite spots, so it's nice to see her here. She was known once upon a time to raise a litter underneath the deck of one of the rooms of the lodge. Hence her nickname as the Queen of Juma. And she spent a lot more time further to the south of our boundary. She is now back north and right next to the lodge once again. So at 12 years old, Karula has one of the most unparalleled records in terms of mothering, and we are currently watching her fifth set of cubs grow up. And what a marvelous job she is doing now. So the little leopard cub that you're looking at, afternoon yours, how are you? Good, thank you. Welcome to go wherever. I'll shift around. I don't know. Only got.
She was in that tree, and there was a civet right on the top. We were just going to check it.
Oh, awesome. I might. Will you let me know, please?
No.
Wonderful, thank you. That's very interesting. I think, actually, maybe I'm wrong. I might be wrong about which leopard cub is with Karula. I thought when it lifted up its head it was Shongile, but it's quite a difficult patch for me to tell. It's quite difficult to see which one. And yours has just said that the female cub, so Shongile, of course, for those of you who are familiar with them, was up one of the nearby trees, and that there was a civet in the tree as well, which is something I would very much like to see, which would be absolutely fascinating. So I think I'm just going to wait for yours to get there. He's looking to see whether or not he can find them. But actually, they've had a few hours to switch around and to munch around in their kills, so let's see how this plays out. Oh, and Heppo, what a wonderful afternoon. Let's go over to Brent and a feathered friend.
Oh, so lucky he didn't fly away. It is a common scimitable who's using his rapier-like beak to... or scimitar-like beak, to probe into every little crevice in the trees, trying to find a little wood borer beetle or something to snack on. Oh, off he goes, the common scimitable. Now, I just heard a bird calling, and we haven't been treated to too many of these birds recently, and these are birds of the wading variety. So we're at Twin Dams, and I think it sounded like a green sandpiper, so we're gonna go very slowly up to the dam wall, peer over the side to see if we can maybe add a water bird or two to our bird list today. And it is a difficult task we've set ourselves. So if anyone knows what is the most birds ever seen on a single drive, please let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. No, he don't fly away. Oh, he's a bit nervous. He's a bit nervous, that one. I'm gonna have to go into stealth mode. Okay. Now Egg's gonna go onto the edge of the water there. Slowly, just to keep a bit wide. Where's he gone? He's right there somewhere. He hasn't flown off, a little bit to the right. He is proving to be elusive. He's disappeared into an elephant footprint. Well, I keep trying to look for him. We can get the Egyptian goose off the list there quickly. There we go, an Egyptian goose. I can't believe I've gone absolutely blind. Now I'm gonna try.
Got it.
Oh, there we go. Well done, Eggs. There it is. Now let's get in a bit. Now you gotta be careful because a lot of the waders look very, very similar. Oh dear, my binoculars have decided to become caught up in my radio. One of them, there we go. So what we're looking for, so we get a couple of different sandpipers here. Now, it is what I thought it was. Yay! I did, let's just double check. You know, you never want to busk with birds. Yes, it is. Is it a green or a wood? Oh, it's one of the two. Are we on super zoom there?
Yeah.
Okay, so what we're looking for, it's definitely not a common. It's too tall, and we're a bit too far. And do those legs look like they've got a little bit of a yellow in them? Difficult to say with someone who marches around in the mud all the time. But I'm pretty sure it's... I haven't seen wading birds for so long. I'm gonna go with my initial feeling is that it's a wood sandpiper. I'm gonna double check now. Oh, there we go. Okay. There we are, now we're in the right. So what we're looking for is the green and the wood are very, very similar. The green has greenish legs and the yellow has yellowish legs, but what we really want to try and see is its eye stripe. Now that is the big discerning factor between these two. Oh dear, that is a... oh, that's even more interesting. What not at you. Okay. Very distinct eye stripe on the one on the right. We'll get to the one on the left shortly. So, the very distinct, it is a wood sandpiper. That one, very distinct eye stripe. Now, let's just try to go a bit forward and see what the one... It looks like it's non-breeding plumage. And, just try to get a little bit closer. The wood sandpiper's taking off, but the other... No, there he goes. Darn it. And so, there he goes. And we're going to take a while to get into the wading birds again. But my gut would tell me, and I'm pretty sure, judging by its coloration, it was a non-breeding marsh sandpiper. Those, how's that, eggs? So there we go. See how much whiter it is? And as it flew away, we saw that very distinct white rump. Well... Oh, it's my phone. I thought it was your camera work. Sorry, Egbert. But there we go. So, there we go. That's probably a new species for quite a few of you. And I'm really hoping we're going to get some wonderful wading birds as the wet season continues. Now, as I said, we're going to focus on the smallest of the small and the flighty and feathery for the beginning of our sunset safari. But it seems like Byron, who's going the opposite way. Let's go see what he's got.
So we've just seen something very exciting, everyone. There's a buffalo bull just watching us through the thicket over there. And we've also managed to find the elephant, but they've just moved off at the moment. They're not far. I can still hear them. There's a big herd that's just moving through the thicket, probably about 100 meters or so from us. We were going to go this way to try and view them, but now there's a buffalo looking at us over there. It seems pretty relaxed, just keeping a good eye on us. And fortunately, and I've been checking the wind the whole time, and you need to remember, whenever you're on a walk, always check the wind just to see if your scent is blowing towards him. But we're very fortunate. The wind is blowing from the animals to us, from the elephant and from the buffalo towards us and away from us. So it's actually perfect conditions. Even though the buffalo has seen us, as long as they can't really smell you, it does help the situation. And if we needed to, we could easily disappear through the thicket and get behind some large trees. That buffalo actually now, and let's just keep an eye on it. It's actually wonderful to be able to...
Now we're still in search for the birds, and we've just found a red-billed hornbill. Sorry about that. We are live in the middle of the bush, so sometimes we do have some slight technical difficulties from time to time. Oh, off he goes, red-billed hornbill. What number is that now, eggs?
I think it's six.
Oh, I can hear more. So when I initially said to Eggsy, how many birds we can get, he says 10. Tata says their bird list is getting much bigger. Hopefully today will be a big push. Here we go. Just one to keep the numbers rolling. One of our more common species, the fork-tailed drongo. Now, I was also hoping this is where the crested barbet nest is, but no sign of the crested barbet. Oh, good wing stretch there, fella. Now, of course, the drongos are part of the flycatcher family, and probably one of the most prominent of the flycatchers, or definitely the most prominent of the flycatchers we get here. They sit out in the open and make lots and lots of noise, and often attack other birds. And also we find them with herds of elephants and impalas as other animals move through, and they scoop up any insect that has been disturbed. Now, we're going to continue on towards my planned spot, which we've been so lucky. I haven't even managed to get to where I planned to start because of all the wonderful things we're seeing. And it is the Mwati River, and more particularly I want to check it is the rarest kingfisher we get here, the grey hooded kingfisher. I want to check where they nested last year, with a couple of woodlands being around. Maybe the grey hooded have also made their way back from Now, as we're moving through, we're going to try to keep that bird list ticking, and you never know what we might see. And often when I've decided to go looking for birds, leopards, wild dogs, elephants, all sorts of things pop up. I'm always checking carefully where there's a little mud wallow. You never know what might be around. There might be some birds drinking. We might get lucky with some not biting flies, but some other waders. And those waders will actually fly massive distances in country between different areas that have had rain, and as it dries, they will move. And a lot of those will actually be non-breeding migrants, just depending on where they've come from. Or we can hear some nice birds down in the Mowati. Now, of course, there's always the chance that we might encounter the nemesis bird, the white-throated robin. They occur all along the Mowati, but in particularly in two areas. But we've only ever managed to get them on camera once. Oh, now here we go. Eggsy, you looking for birds now? There we go, we can hear a bird. Where are you, bird, that is calling? You spotted it. Ah, well spotted, Eggwerk. It is a, well, since we didn't get a good view of it last time, but it's another common scimitable. It's a very beautiful bird. And as I said, we will stop and look, even if we have got them, because that is a stunning, stunning bird. And that scimitable, look how it uses it to needle it in between the bark and into the any little hole in the wood to try and get some wood borer beetles out. A very noisy starling somewhere. Oh, there we go, he got one. Did you see that? He got a little wood borer grub. Oh, he's got another one. Oh, poor wood borers. Oh, well done. Oh, well done, little scimitable. I'm just going to move. Ah, there he is. Right on the top of that leadwood tree. I know it's going to be quite difficult to see him. I'm sure we'll see another one again. But he's making so much noise, I can't ignore him. It's a... Yes, the Birchall starling. Now I've got a bird quiz, since we're birding today. And let's see how our birders are. Now this is a bit of an obscure bird quiz. There we go. Eggsy's got a starling in silhouette, a Birchall starling in silhouette for you. Now we've seen two birds already today. We've seen the great spotted cuckoo and the Birchall starling. And can you tell me what they have in common? And what do the Birchall starling... Actually, no, let me rephrase this. Why would a great spotted cuckoo look for a Birchall starling? Who can tell me why a great spotted cuckoo looks for Birchall starlings? And if you know the answer to that, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv. Okay. Now, this is normally one of my favorite flutterby or butterfly hunting grounds, because quite often all the sedges are not out just yet, but the flowers on the sedges often attract a lot of butterflies to this area. But I think we're going to have to wait a week or two and see some of the... Ooh. Okay, eggs. Now it's time for some serious skill level. You see that one? Okay, in this little hole here. Just zoom slowly. Keep going, that thing there. No, to where my finger is? There. Oh, a little bit down. Oh, damn it, he moved. Where'd he go? Did you see him? It was a tiny little blue butterfly. Okay, I'm gonna walk there, see if we can disturb him, and so we can find out where he went. And as I do that, I don't know if he went too far. Oh, but they are so small, it's so hard to catch them. But as I said, some of the sedges and some of, actually there's some other stuff here that's also, oh, there he is, okay. You see that flower. So there's three very tall flowers on the far, the third one, right on top. Do you have them? Okay, wait, let me come look at the monitor. Okay. Okay. So, wait, you got him? Okay, so down to the right a little bit and zoom in, center frame. Look at that. There's a tiny little blue. And oh, we learnt this one last season, but they disappear for so long, it's sometimes difficult to remember them. Okay, now, I'm trying to remember now what he is, but look how exquisite that little butterfly is. Oh dear, how did that happen? Oh dear. Now, I'm trying to remember his name now. Give me, there we go. That's him. That's him. Now, what we're looking for in these little blues, especially when we're looking at the outside, so the inside's almost always similar, but quite a lot of them have little eyes on the outside. This one is the one species that doesn't, and it is called a dotted blue. And another thing he lacks is the little wings, or little tails, like a roller's rackets. And some of the little blues have those. This one doesn't. It is called a dotted blue, even though they're not the bluest of the blues. I'm just going to make sure, and what else are we looking at? Does he have a border on the edge of his wings? No, he doesn't. I'm just making sure. As I said, it's been quite a while since we got to see Jennifer Sherman says it's a cheetah-winged butterfly. Just kidding. Yes, now, well, you're not far off. It is a spotted blue. That is its name. Now, I was hoping it was going to open its wings for us so we could have a look. But definitely a spotted blue. The other thing, and when he does move a little bit, you can see he's got a striped thorax or striped, oh sorry, not a thorax, a striped abdomen. Well, he's enjoying the first flowers of the season. That's right, man. I don't think he's gonna open, so I'll show you what he looks like when he does open. There we go. So that's the dotted blue, you can see. That's what he looks like. And that's what he looks like when he opens his wings. And they can be quite a lot more blue, but the trick is to look at the underside with the blue butterflies. So you can see, if you look at the colouring, they're all very, very similar. So the trick is to really look at the outside, whether they've got eyes, whether they've got rackets. Well, there we go. Our first, well, new butterfly. I think we've done some citrus swallowtails and some of the more common ones, but not often we get to see exquisite little butterflies like that, and they're the most difficult to identify. So my butterfly hotspot produced a butterfly, yay! Very well done to Jordan. Indeed, the quiz I asked, the reason the great spotted cuckoo looks for starlings is because that is, in this area, their favorite brood parasite. So the great spotted cuckoo will find a starling's nest, kick out the starling's eggs, and lay its own in place. Now, let's go have a quick look here. So this, oopsie. Oh, is that a bit too fast there? But now, last year, during the wet season, this was the home to a grey hooded kingfisher. This year, not yet. There's no sign of any bird feces, but they might use a different hole. Let's have a look. Spiders closed up, spiders closed up. Let's have a look. Oh, that one, whoa, that's also got spiders in it. Now, what I'm looking for is little white droppings. None of these are being used by birds at the moment. Normally in clay banks like this, it's bee eaters and kingfishers are your two most common birds that like to nest there. So we'll keep checking. Okay, you ready, eggs? See, on the flower, you got him. Perfect, well done. A little bit to the right, a little bit down. Ha ha, one of the little tipped butterflies. So, ooh, that's a nice one. You see how it's got a double stripe? I'm trying to remember, is that the, I think that's the scarlet. Oh, off it flutters, as butterflies do. Now, you've got to remember, All right, there we go. No, I was incorrect. It's not the scarlet. Oh, there we go. Well done. Eggs has found it again. Absolutely beautiful. Now, see, again, very important to look when they close their wings what they look like to get which species they are. Now, there are a lot of them. They are very difficult, but that one in itself is called, very seductively, a smoky orange tip. So, there we go. Where's the smoky? There we go. A smoky orange tip. And you can see those double bands that were in the middle. Now, they can be, there's a massive amounts of variation in these butterflies, so you do have to be very careful. And the wonderful thing about this is that I'm relearning my butterflies with you. Well, at least I can still remember which family they're in. Get us in the right general area. Okay, now what wonders await around the next corner? There are some wonderful big jackalberries, and they're also called African ebony trees. Always a good spot to look for birds. Well, we're going to look for birds in this type of area now. We have found a mammal. There's a vervet monkey, and there. A little bit lower. Here we go, on the ground. Monkeys also like these riverine areas, lots of fruit trees. Oh, there's a butterfly with the monkey. Oh, it's gone. That was even a bit far. That was a bit far for a butterfly to identify. Foraging along the edge of the Mwati River. Now, of course, monkeys are omnivores. They'll eat fruit, insects, birds, baby birds, eggs, and
dear everybody, it sounds like the gremlins are attacking us today. We haven't had much luck. I lost you with the buffalo and the elephant, unfortunately, and now you've just lost Brent. But we have found something small and interesting. Have a look at this little spider, beautiful light green spider that is just hiding in there. It's interesting. It's got a web right around the little branches, and it's sitting hidden, so well hidden inside that bit of webbing. I'm not too sure what spider this is. Could possibly be a grass spider of sorts, but I'm not 100% sure exactly what species. Wonderful to see this. As I said, it's such a pity. We had such a wonderful sighting there. We had the buffalo watching us and the elephants in the background, and the elephants eventually started moving and pushed the buffalo off. We got to see the elephants and then they carried on. We are going to still try and see if we can view them from on foot. What we're going to do is we're going to walk around and do a big loop just to try and get out of that area where that buffalo was too. It was a lone male, so we don't want to push our boundaries too much with it. And as you know, buffalo can be quite unpredictable. It seemed relaxed, did see us and decided to move off, but we don't want to push it too much. So we're going to do a big loop around and see if we can see those elephant. I'd love to show you the elephant on foot. So who knows, we might still get lucky. So we're going to start moving around and make our way back towards the road and do a big loop. And we'll see what else we can find. Who knows? While we do that, let's head back to Jamie and get an update from her and see what she's got.
Look at how cool this is. I just had this report from Yours that one of the leopard cubs had chased a genet up to the top of a marula tree. And look at this. Oh, isn't it gorgeous? It looks like, to me, a large spotted genet as opposed to a small spotted genet, but this is probably one of the best views we are ever going to get of what is ultimately a very shy, very secretive nocturnal creature. And it's found itself the most awkward position. I wish you could have seen Jandre and I searching for it. I mean, how I didn't crash the car, I feel as though my neck is now permanently frozen in a sort of upright-looking position. It is hidden, right curled up at the top of a marula tree. Oh, brave decision, Jandre, to show it. Well done. Okay, there's the marula tree. That's why it took us so long to find it. Makes you wonder how many times we've driven past them. So there you go, a really nice surprise for this afternoon, and we have yours to thank for it. Day, well done. It really did take us a long time to figure out exactly where this beautiful thing was. Look at his tiny, tiny little feet. A foot that leaves a track that's no bigger than my thumbnail. A beautiful... Genets are a funny thing. To describe them for some of you, because of course this one is curled up in the tree and therefore you can't fully see what it looks like, they look like some kind of odd mixture between a mongoose or a ferret and a cat. That's sort of where they fall in the spectrum of animals to try and understand exactly what it is they are. That being said, they are neither mongoose nor cat. They are part of the viverrid family. Which is a completely... They used to be lumped together, if I remember correctly, from old taxonomic breakdown. They used to be thought to be in the same family group as mongoose, but they've since been separated into their own distinct family, or at least mongoose have. And the genets have remained in the viverrid category. I don't think I've ever had the opportunity to closely study a genet's face and its features before. This is such a rare and exciting treat. It's found, I mean, it looks precariously balanced, but it's obviously found the safest place possible for it. And shame, I guess it's just going to have to wait. It's going to have to wait it out until it knows that the leopards have gone before it decides to come down once again. Perhaps it will wait until darkness, since, as I said, it is a nocturnal creature, before it creeps down. But it seems as though even brave Hosanna, intrepid Hosanna, and his notorious tree climbing skills, seems as though even he was not quite brave enough to venture out to those far-reaching branches, which I think you'll all agree was probably a very, very wise decision. Well, there you go, Mary. You say you have never even heard of a genet before. Well, I'm glad that we could share it with you. We've seen them once or twice on the live safaris. It depends, because of course our times change throughout the year, depending upon the sunrise and the sunset. It depends on if we go out late enough into the evening to see them, because they only really start coming out way after, or a good half an hour after dark. And we've seen a few of them around. I found what I thought was a genet's nest, but when I went back and I tried to double check, I never saw it once again. So perhaps it was just a temporary sleeping hollow. But I'm so glad that we could share this little creature with you. Every time I look up now, I'm scared I'm not going to see it, but I've got it now. I've figured out. Yours thought it was the funniest thing in the world. He had to come and show me where it was, because I was terribly confused. It's sleeping away. So it's one of those creatures that is very, very secretive and that we hardly ever get to see. It's far more rare than a leopard sighting, probably even rarer than a cheetah sighting based on numbers, or around those sorts of numbers in terms of how many times we see one per year. Little eyes opening up. They are very sweet. And they patrol regular pathways and deposit their anal pasting, just like civets do, just like mongoose do. They all that the mustelids, so the honey badgers, the civets, the viverrids, the genets, and the mongoose are all grouped together in sort of the same evolutionary line, thanks largely, or one of the sort of the big unifying factors is the presence of anal glands that they use to deposit secretions everywhere. And that, of course, also starts sort of giving you a key to their evolutionary background in terms of how closely related they are to hyenas that do something very, very similar. Our leopards, Leopards are interesting things. They are probably, of all of the big cats, they are the ones that I think have the most success in terms of killing, catching and killing things like genets and then the sort of small to medium-sized cats. It seems to be one of their sort of expertise, and it's probably just because they're the only one of the big cats that are agile enough to actually equal the speed and agility and nimbleness of the tinier creatures. Oh, here's an interesting thing. Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, you wanted to know if they always, if genets always sleep in trees or if it's only because the leopards are there. If I had to hazard a guess, it's a guess, my guess would be that the normal sleeping spot of this particular genet is the hollow in that tree, right there, close to the base of the trunk. I'm sorry about the antenna in the way, but there you go. That would be my guess as to where the genet sleeps, this particular genet sleeps at night. So no, they do not sleep out and exposed in the way that this genet is now. And what you'll probably find happened, because apparently this is where the Inyala kill was originally made by Karula. This poor unsuspecting genet came out to go about its nightly business, took one look at the leopard, and shot up to the highest branches of the tree. Or, possibly, it was returning from its evening business to go back to its usual sleeping spot and all of a sudden discovered it was being pursued by a leopard cub. And it could have been either Hosana or Shungile. Although, apparently, Yors tells me that Shungile was here with it earlier. But that might have been just because she was fascinated by the whole thing. Imagine how a very, I suppose, looks so comfortable. I would be absolutely terrified, but then I'm not a genet. Oh, look at that. In that light, you can even see the veins in its ears. Or its one ear. How cool is that? Look at the way it's swaying in the wind. That's not Gendre just woozing around with the camera. That's Gendre woozing around with the camera. That poor thing is wobbling around at the top there and yet somehow manages to sleep. I'd be seasick. Marie, you say, could I please show you a picture of it later? With absolute pleasure, I'll find one for you and I will show you. I think it is a large spotted genet. It is a little bit tricky to tell, just in terms of looking at it from this angle, with its tail dangling. Unfortunately, Marie, I don't have my mammal book. I've been doing a little bit of shifting around with various boxes, and I've currently got James's box because I am in the process of purchasing James's camera. So I've got James's box at the moment, so I don't have a picture in my book, but I can absolutely find a picture for you. So this, hold on a second, let me just figure this out one extra time. Let me show you the difference between small spotted and large spotted genets. As the name suggests, the spots are smaller in a small spotted genets, but not really by much. Now this gives you a nice, Marie, this will give you a really nice indication of exactly what it is a genet looks like. This is the small spotted one, but the difference is minimal between the different species. White tipped tail, the large spotted tends to have a black tipped tail. So that's the genet that you're looking at now. That is the creature that's curled up there. That is when it's slightly less terrified by leopards and less curled up on the top of marula trees. Now they're actually quite fascinating looking things. Pretty, huh? Very, very pretty. Now, usually what this genet would be focused on doing would be to, when it starts to get dark, it would go down and it would go foraging for the night. And Susie, you want to know if they are carnivorous? Yes, they are. They are. They essentially will follow the same diet as something like an African wildcat. And I think you'd probably find, sort of pound for pound, they're not that far apart in terms of weight. An African wildcat's probably slightly heavier, but not by much. So they're on the same sort of scale in terms of size, and they are very good climbers. So they go after things like snakes, small rodents, amphibians, insects. You'll probably find at the moment a large portion of their diet is insect-based. Well, going from something very tiny and very fluffy to something much, much larger, let's go and see what Byron has for you on foot.
Oh,
I've managed to just find a little marula fruit, everyone. And it's not ripe yet, it's still very, very green. But they are rich in vitamin C, and one of the animals that loves feeding on these are obviously the elephants. And guess what? We've managed to find the herd of elephants we wanted to see. Now they've just moved off a little bit through the thicket. There's a little one with them. Hang on, let's sit tight here for a little while. We should see them moving across the road fairly soon. Yeah, the branch is breaking again. I'm trying to get another view. I think if you follow me this way, yeah, I think Viam, if we come around this side, we might get a nice view. And again, the wind's in our favor, everyone, so we don't really have anything to worry about. Even though it is a herd, there's some lovely big trees and marulas that we can use as cover. So it's really not an issue at all. And generally, you can tell if elephants are happy or not. Let's just see if we can get a view of them again. Here we go. I can just see some legs moving through the thicket. Not too far ahead of us, probably about 80 meters or so. We may even get a view through here. Let me just have a look. And the whole time while we are walking and scanning, just, here we go, you can see some through here. There's one straight ahead feeding. This is lovely. We've got a lovely bit of a vantage point, actually. Let me just have a look through here. Ah, here we go. Can I have a look at this? Here we go, everyone. Wow, look at the baby. Just down at the bottom. Isn't that fantastic? Wonderful. As I said, we've got a perfect vantage point here. We're actually on higher ground compared to where the elephant are. And also the wind is still in our favor, so everything is perfect at the moment. These conditions, even though it can change very quickly, we always have to keep that in mind. So we do always still have a look if we need to, where to head for safety. But where we are at the moment, I think we're pretty safe. And these elephants seem happy feeding and moving around. Oh. It's wonderful. Isn't that great? Finally, we get to see the elephant. And I really, you know, I've always said in my last stint here, I love elephants so much, and to be able to see them and spend time with them is fantastic, and even more so on foot. And again, you do have to be a little bit careful, especially with herds of elephant, with the youngsters around. They are very protective, and we do appear to be a predator. So they may react to us, but again, I think if you quiet and view them from a distance and they decide to approach you, they generally do become a lot more relaxed. Michael, you wanted to know my scariest elephant encounter on foot. Well, Michael, I had one. I did have one that was very scary and quite close, but I wasn't walking guests or anything. I was actually in the camp, and this was quite a few years ago, but I was in camp, and this big elephant bull came and he constantly came into the camp and was causing a lot of damage. And the one day he came in, and the owners asked if we could just try and see if we can chase him out. And occasionally, if you make a noise behind them, and that, they do tend to move away. They don't like the smell or the sound of people, so they do tend to move away. But this elephant bull was very upset to begin with. It had seen a few people and was getting agitated. And as we followed this elephant, he was walking towards the access to the camp. So we thought, we'll just wait till he gets closer and then chase him off. Anyway, he turned and caught a glimpse of us in the corner of his eye. We hadn't even made a sound yet. And he just turned and he charged without warning. He just turned and charged. He wasn't happy and didn't want us following him. And this big elephant bull came running towards us. And I clapped my hands, as you do usually, is if you try and make a noise, clap your hands, wave your arms, usually they stop and they back off, but he kept coming, so it was quite an interesting experience, and I actually turned then to try and run, but I tripped and I fell, and this elephant stopped about 5 meters away from me, but he just stopped, and there was a lot of dust and some trumpeting, and turned, and as he turned, he moved off, and I managed to get up and run to the nearest little house, staff house, and then he ran, and ran out the camp. So that was the closest encounter I've ever had. But I think, it was our fault, you know, trying to get him away and cause him to be quite upset. But these elephants are very relaxed at the moment, feeding. They're not moving around too much. We might spend a little bit more time in the area, otherwise we'll continue. But while we do that, let's head over to Brent and see what he is up to.
Well, look at this. Aren't we being spoiled today with the little water birds, with all the pans around here? And getting my waders back up to scratch. Now, this is the second little wood sandpiper of the day. There we go. Isn't it just a beautiful little bird? So they feed off aquatic invertebrates. Ooh. There we go. Raisa says, in September, the killer bees did 38 species on a sunrise drive. It is going to be a push to get close to that. But there we go. Beautiful little wood sandpiper. Well, you've always got to be careful between the green and the wood. And I'm very confident that we are spot on. And we're going to let him to carry on with his dinner of aquatic invertebrates. So things like dragonfly larvae, mayfly larvae, stonefly larvae. And I can hear a sunbird eggs. It sounded like it was right here. Let's see. They are so small and they are so fast. Oh, there it is. I'm just gonna try to get you into a spot where you can get to them. Oh, you got him there, eggs?
No.
Okay. Oh, I think it might be two. Okay, keep zoom. It says he moved. No, he's still there. Keep zooming. Is that as high as you can go? Right. Let me just try reposition again for you. See if we can get a slightly better angle on this. Can hear that high-pitched call. Oh no, there he goes. Oh, follow him. He's landed in a better tree, thank goodness. Oh, you know what he's after. He's after, there's wild jasmine growing in that acacia. Now, oh. I can't see him, he's disappeared, but there's another bird there on top. You got him, Eggs?
No.
Top left. There we go, middle frame. Oh, it's the first redback shrike of the season! There we go. First redback shrike of the season. So. And you can see that little hooked shrike beak. Isn't that stunning? So they've come all the way from Europe. the red-backed shrike. I'm still trying to see that little beautiful little white-bellied sunbird who's in there somewhere. And there we go. So that is our first red back shrike of the season. And that is a female, the one we were looking at. So they breed throughout Europe and Western Asia, all the way up into Scandinavia, and they winter in the dry savannas of Africa. So a female redback shrike. Be hoping for lots of bugs to eat after that long flight. Okay, well, let's keep moving. I don't know what number we're on, Eggs. What do you think? It must be about 10.
36.
Eggsy says we're on 36 already. I don't think so, Eggs, I'm afraid. As much as I would love to be, I'd say we're on about 10. Okay, well, we're going to keep searching for wonders of feathered creatures, and I know a spot that's always good for a feathered friend or two. I'm going to start making my way there. While we do that, let's go enjoy a really unique and rare sighting, a daytime sighting of a genet.
So it sounds as though Brent is having a marvellous time chasing down the various bird species, so he's put the first red-backed shrike on camera. We'll have to equal the challenge, but for now I feel as though I want to spend a little bit more time with our genet. While you've been away, I've been desperately trying to get a view of, since I can't really see the rest of the spots, I'm trying to have a look at the tip of the tail. Now, I mentioned that the small spotted genet has a white tip at the end of its tail, and that I suspected that this was a large spotted genet. And that, I think, seems to be confirmed by the black tuft at the end of its fur. There's not a massive difference. The large spotted genet is slightly more robust, but other than that, there's not much difference between the two species. And I apologize because I actually think the small spotted genet's name has changed. I think it is now the common genet, but I grew up knowing it as the small spotted genet, and it will, for me, always be the small spotted genet. But this, I think, is a large spotted, and I've noticed that the majority of the genet sightings that we have here seem to be large spotted. Now, a little bit earlier on, I was asked whether or not they are carnivores, and I compared them to a wildcat in terms of diet, and I was thinking about it now, and I don't think that was actually the best description. That's a very silly impala. Sorry. We'll go back to the genet in a second. Little male impala, you are walking straight towards Karula. Straight towards her. There's a very good chance she could try and go for it if it gets any closer. It's still a little bit far. Ooh, little impala. Not impossible despite the fact that she has a meal. Oh. No, still hasn't realized. Not impossible that she could go for it, you know. We've seen Tundi with 3 impala kills. She just has to be awake and alert enough. She might be sleeping off a full belly. That's the tree that the kill was in, so he's walking right past it. Karula, where are you? What are you doing? I can't see her. No, I can't see either of them. Wait, here he comes. Here comes Impala. He stopped, suddenly realized something is not right. And now he continues. This may be the luckiest young Impala ram we ever did see. She could still go for it. She could still. And he... Okay, I think he's out of the woods. Now, if she was going to go for him, it would have been when he was a little bit closer. Leopards, of course, ambush predators. They are short bursts of speed only. So that is, you're looking at probably one of the luckiest impala rams we've seen today. And despite the fact that he actually has no idea just how truly lucky he got there. He walked right past, I think she's lying up behind the termite mound, so I think it blocked your view and our view completely. But we would have seen, if she had come dashing out, we would have seen her go for him. Sorry, I got distracted completely from the jennet. Bye-bye, little impala. Off he goes. Wow. I think that's the most oblivious impala I've ever seen. They are usually so alert and aware of their surroundings. And their eyesight, she must have just been very, very still. Their eyesight is so incredibly attuned to movement. She obviously didn't move, and therefore he didn't pick up on the fact that she was right there. Oh, there you go. Off goes the little impala. It wouldn't have been impossible for us to kill her. It wouldn't have been impossible that she would have made the effort to kill it, even though she has, in fact, got food with her at the moment. But let's go back to our jennet, tucked away in the top of the tree. I was speaking earlier about the fact that I was thinking about my comparison earlier. Oh, it's shifted. It's moved. Has it moved? It has. Its head's now on the left. About my comparison with a wildcat's diet, and actually I think probably it would be more comparable to something like a jackal's diet, only with less scavenging. That's because it will do it will eat fruit, it will pick up jackalberry berries and things like that. So there's a little bit of an omnivorous side to the spotted jennet's diet. Shame. It obviously can't get comfortable and can't sleep properly. And it's just going to have to wait patiently right at the tip-top of the marula tree. Can you see the glow of the light shining through the top of its ears? I wonder if it's thinking about coming down. I doubt it. I think it's going to wait until after dark before seeking refuge. Shame. Imagine how frustrating it must be for this little jennet. Now, Hayley, you wanted to know if jennets live a solitary life, and yes, they do. Unless they're much like leopards, unless they're coming together to mate, or unless they are raising their babies. Ooh, here's a question. What's a baby jennet called? Is it a pup or a cub or a... Elvis, she's in the Mkulu Shlashla off to your right there. She might be lying up behind round the termite mound. I'm looking at a jennet in this tree. Hello. Hello, gorgeous. Aren't you beautiful? Look at it peering down at us. Sorry, we were talking about family structures. So unless they are raising babies... Oh, look at that. I hope you're getting some amazing screenshots of this jennet's face, because this is a very rare opportunity indeed. I have on the camera trap, I used to work quite a lot with Panthera and quite a lot of sifting through many, many... You okay there, Jandre? many camera trap photos, and one of my favorite ones was a female jennet with five little ones jogging along behind her. I'm asking... If any of you can try and figure out exactly, look at that eye, what a baby jennet is called, because I have to be honest, I think it's a kit. Is it a kitten? Is it a kit? I honestly do not know. I can't believe I must have known at some point, but I honestly don't know what it is. But yes, a fantastic picture of the adult female and five little ones trailing behind her. It's an amazing picture. It's the joys of camera traps. It's okay, Jennet. We don't mean you any harm, I promise you that. I'm certainly not going to go racing up to the top of that tree. I think that would be beyond even James, in terms of climbing ability. Don't you just want that branch to move ever so slightly, Chandra? Just, it's as though the leaves are perfectly covering its eyes. There we go. So, Robin, thank you very much. You say baby genets are called kits. I was going through the list in my head, and I was sort of coming to the conclusion that it was a kit, like a baby ferret, but thank you very much for clarifying. Very much appreciated. And while I fall under some very close scrutiny of a large spotted genet, let's go back over to Byron and see what else he has to offer on walk.
That is incredible that Jamie has got the genet as well as the leopard and that impala, the very lucky impala that was heading towards Karula. Now have a look what we found, everybody. Beautiful little grasshopper, and it's hiding from Vium a little bit. Keeps twisting and moving around to the side of the... There we go. Look at that. Look at those wonderful colors. Isn't that incredible? Now, usually you do get these in large numbers, these little grasshoppers. They do a lot of damage to plants and that. But this little one's by itself. But it's incredible colors. I've never seen one so beautifully colorful with all these red and black stripes. Really is interesting. A bit of a light pinkish on the legs. Those red eyes. It's a beautiful grasshopper. It's so wonderful to spot these little creatures that we don't often see. It does take a bit of patience and looking very, very carefully. But it's amazing what is out here when you do start taking notice and spending time looking for these little creatures and these little insects. There are so many different insects and it's very difficult to identify all of them. And I know that some scientists and that are still identifying different species of insects and butterflies and so on. It's incredible. Look at that. That's beautiful. Don't want to disturb him too much. He seems very happy on this little branch. So let's continue and see what else we can find. From everything from those large elephants that we saw earlier to this beautiful grasshopper, it's wonderful to be out and it's a nice cool breeze now, so it's lovely temperature to be walking. And we'll see what else we can find. You can see a bit overcast and cloudy at the moment. Still a few sun rays just coming through the clouds. Really is a lovely afternoon. We've been fortunate with this cool weather because when it does get very, very hot, it can be quite unpleasant early in the afternoon or in the morning, the later mornings. It can get very, very hot. Now look at this. This is interesting, everyone. What has happened here is this is an abandoned termite mound, an old termite mound. It's been broken down a little bit, but I think what's possibly used that afterwards is perhaps some mongoose, and most likely a little banded mongoose. And the banded mongoose, or maybe even the dwarf mongoose. I would say this is probably dwarf mongoose. They do use these abandoned termite mounds quite regularly for homes and burrows to live in. And these holes are perfect, and the perfect size for them. What happens is with these termite mounds, there's a system of chimneys that move throughout the termite mound, and that's to circulate air through them. So what happens is these little creatures come once the termites have moved out, and they'll use this as a little burrow. And because of those chimneys, it's very easy to burrow. They don't have to dig up or excavate too much of the soil. They'll just make the holes a little bit bigger for the entrance, and then they'll live and sleep in these little burrows and eventually move on if they find a new area, new territory that they'll move around in. That's nice to see. Also get snakes using them. And yeah, there's a big termite mound with a lot of holes in it. So I wouldn't be surprised if there are perhaps one or two snakes in this abandoned termite mound at the moment. And I know from experience and seeing a lot of pythons love to move into these old termite mounds. It's very warm inside there, so during the winter it's a perfect place for them to hibernate. And if you're lucky, you do see pythons coming out, and they'll lie on these termite mounds, bask in the sun, warm up for a little bit, and then return back into the burrow or into the termite mound to continue their hibernation. But there are times of the year where they do come out, and they do also mate around that time in winter. I think July, August, if I'm not mistaken, there is usually quite a bit of python activity, and then they return back into the termite, finish the hibernation, and then come out again in the summer and probably get a lot more active. But there could potentially be quite a few snakes in here. We're going to continue looking for little tiny creatures and see what we can find. Let's head back to Brent and see what he's up to.
We decided to come to quarantine, get some of the more common species quickly out the way. There we go, the red-billed buffalo weaver. That is the next one on our list. And there are also some starlings. We're going to have to get a little bit closer to see which ones that they are. Okay. Now I can hear a Birchall's, but we've seen one of those already. There are some either Cape Glossy or lesser blue-eared glossy starlings up ahead. We're going to have a closer look now. But the weather is turning against our birding endeavour. Wind making some of the birds a bit skittish. Here he is sitting on top there. Now, you've got to look carefully at these guys to see which one it is. Oh, sorry, it's not lesser bluehead. The name. So what we're looking for, which is quite difficult in the light, one of the things we're looking for is dark ear. So it's much darker around. Yes, no, that is a greater blue-eared starling, not the Cape Glossy. So there we go. You see those darkness around the eye patch there, or the ear coverts. Okay, here we go. Let's go. That one's down. This is going to be, oh, but that's so pretty. We have to show them, Exy. It's just too beautiful. Look at that. Look at that. The light rays breaking through the cloud. Making quite a spectacular scene there. Look at that. Oh, it's too pretty. Yes, and this weather is not conducive to birding. It's turned a bit windy, but we will keep on. We have said we are going to try beat 38, and if we manage to beat that on a sunset safari, oof, I would say I would eat my hat, but now there's a microphone in it, so I can't. Okay, so we're going to quickly shoot across quarantine. Fari 5 would like to know, how many birds are on my life list? Well, for Africa, there are 2,300 or so species in Africa, and I'm about 1,600. Quickly, Crested Barber, don't fly away. Don't dare fly away. Let's go forward. Where's he gone? There he is. Crested Barbet gets onto the list. Well done, Crested Barbet. Okay, there we go, Crested Barbet. We gotta do what we can with this wind. Okay, having a quick look. So yes, so I'm quite lucky. I'm lacking a few Congo-based species, actually a lot of Congo-based species, and then the Sahel and Sahara species. I haven't spent any time up there. So those are two, and Ethiopia, which has got lots of endemics. I think I'll probably get easy 100 plus species in Ethiopia. So on average, I think I'm doing quite well with my bird list. As much as I love birding, as you can see, I bird quite frequently with you guys on the drive, and the chances of me seeing a bird I've never seen before on Jumo in the Sabi Sands is very, very slim, unless there's a rare vagrant that pops out somewhere. But no, not even the guinea fowls were here. They were here earlier. They're gone. Eggsy, you chased them. Not Eggsy. Must have been Byron and Viam chase and Herbie chasing the guinea fowl. Now, fortunately, since I'm coming up short with the birds at the moment, Jamie has the incredible leopards of Juma chewing on something.
Chewing on the remains of her nyala, and what a beautiful shot this is of the wonderful queen. We've left our Janet for now, and we're now looking at this incredible view of Karula. And I'm sorry, I'm a little distracted. I'm just want to get onto the Game Drive channel to explain to the guys that they don't need to worry about all of the vultures on Gallagher Shortcut. Oh, there we go. It's okay. Ephraim's done it for me. There we go. Everybody was a little bit concerned about the gathering of vultures on Gallagher Shortcut. They didn't know about the lion kills that were there. We've got this absolutely stunning view. I think that there's a very good chance that Karula's going to be gone by tomorrow morning, because I think this is all that is left of her nyala kill. A little bit earlier, a pair of bushbuck looked as though they were about to walk straight into her once again. They didn't realize she was there until they were almost right on top of her, and then they dashed off and away. And the rest of this young nyala's family, or herd, has been wandering about over the last few minutes. They're moving backwards and forwards, walking past the lodge. Oh, just like that. A female leopard or an adult leopard will only really crunch through bones like this of a large antelope when it's a young antelope. So with Steenbok and Dacre, they're capable of eating up all of the bones, but with Nyala, she would only be able to eat some of the smaller bones. She would never be able to crunch through a leg like she has if it were an adult animal. I mean, look at that, that's all but gone. Is she going to eat the hoof as well? Could be. They do occasionally do that. A lot of the time they end up coughing it up in the leopard equivalent of a hairball. And they often, well, they sometimes even vomit it up if they take on a piece of hoof that's too big to digest. That's amazing. Look at that. She is actually eating the hoof as well. You can see the back molars acting as that carnassial shear to break through and crush the keratin of the hooves. Takes a little bit of saliva, which makes sense. It's not exactly the juiciest part of the nyala, but it does have value in terms of nutrients, particularly the bone, in terms of calcium and bone marrow. There. Yep. Spit that bit out, Karula. The keratin's not very nice, is it? Yuck. I hope you all got some amazing screenshots of the accompanying facial expressions there, because they were really very special. And now that she has spat out the leftovers, it looks as though Princess Shungile is about to come down the tree. I'm not entirely sure which way down she's going to go. Slowly, but... Shungi? That's not the best side of the tree. That's okay. She's going to creep her way slowly down the back. When talking earlier, I happened to be in final control when Brent was with Karula and her cubs at the Dacre kill not too long ago, and when Hosanna was climbing down the tree. And it always seems to me as though his sister has a certain degree more in terms of coordination and grace Hosanna tends to be a little bit occasionally like a little bit like a bull in a china shop in his approach to things. He just kind of goes barreling in without much thought and occasionally falls down. Shungile has a much more measured approach. Although she seems to be quite content to stay there, where she is practically invisible but for a dangling tail. Karuda's looking back towards the garden of the lodge, and I think that's where Hosanna is, and I think we should go and have a quick look, because Jandre spotted him, or says he spotted him earlier. Now let's go and have a look and see if we can catch up with the little prince as well. We can have all of the royal family this afternoon. I think that's what she's looking at. Let's go and see quickly. We'll come back to her. I don't think she's going to move just yet, although the kill is all finished. And we'll go and have a look and see whether or not her... Oh, wait, hold on. Here comes Shungi. Sorry, I can't help but shorten it because a friend of mine had a dog called Shungi, which was short for Shungalolo. I automatically keep wanting to call Shungile Shungi. Hello? I know. Jandre just went, oh, from behind the camera. There's something amazing about that bright-eyed expression that they have. So unique to leopard cubs. Oh, beautifully done. Oh, mom and daughter duo. Quick greeting to mom. Perhaps coming to see whether there's anything left to eat, and maybe even thinking about going back to where she had that Janet cornered. No, she's interested in lunch. Sorry, Shungile. There is not much left. I think Mom has eaten it all. It's fascinating to watch the way that these leopards divide the meals that they have, sort of tagging in every now and again. So one of them will eat, and then the next one will come and take its place, and then Karula will come and take its place. She's looking back towards the fence. A very good question from Marie while we look at the focused Queen of Juma. I think actually there's a good chance Hassan is going to come to us. Marie, you want to know why it is that leopards look so clean when they feed when lions look so dirty? I think one of the big things is prey size. So leopards tend to go for things that are much, much smaller than the lions do. So it doesn't involve as much of the whole tucking one's head into the carcass in order to feed. There's also very little competition, so they're not fighting each other for it. And therefore they can take a little bit more time to go about eating with a bit more delicacy. Oh, look, how graceful was that? Displaced. I think Karula's going to go and fetch her son. Now this will probably be the last few moments that we can spend with him for a little while this afternoon. That's just because there are other vehicles waiting to come into the sighting. Hello, little one. Following on behind Mum. Hello. While our leopard family stalks back towards where I think Hosanna is, let's head over to Brent and find out how his afternoon is going.
Well, there we go. Another one for our list. We found quite a nice little bird party here. And there is the African hoopoo. And they call very stink. Oop, 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 oop. Now, where did those others go? Did they do a disappearing act on us? I think they did. Oh, in the sky. I got him. There we go. White-backed vulture. Is he going to show us the back? Or he's just flying at a weird angle. Landing gear's down. Going down to where the Nkuma's abandoned that buffalo. There we go. White back vulture. That's another one for the list. Okay, let's just go forward a little bit. There were some white helmet strikes, but they flitter and flutter away. Remember, this is 100% live. We are bird watching. We are trying to beat a record that I set with Brian in September of 38 species in one game drive. I still think one day I'm going to get to that miracle 50 in one game drive. I think it is going to be a sunrise safari, however, and the birds are a little bit more active, and the weather's turned a little bit against us so far. I think we're on about 13 or 14 species. Even if we get to around 30, I think we've done well. I think we're more than likely going to struggle to get to 25. But I do have my secret spot. And there's a little spot on the main access road to Vuyatela that every time I go there, it seems to be amazingly diverse bird parties. But while we're there, we're still scoping out. We've got some short grass up ahead, which means we could get some lapwings and other birds that are not really in the woodland area where we are at the moment. We could get multiple species of lapwings. Okay, we're about to appear out onto the open area known as Sandy Patch. And of course, we've got to get most of our birding in before it's dark. The bonus species will be those nocturnal birds we don't see too often. Owls, nightjars, coursers, thick knees. Just to push that level a little bit further, because we're not going to get them on the sunrise safari, well, not very commonly. Okay, here we go. Exciting stuff. Is everyone ready? What birds await us on the open plains at Sandy Patch? Dump, 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 dump. We're nearly there. And we're going to slide in silently as we freewheel down the slight slope. What are we going to find? Eggsy, any guesses? Eggsy says we're going to find an ostrich. Eggsy is being a comedian today. I would be very happy if we found an ostrich. It is a bird. I've only ever seen an ostrich on Juma once. Okay. Watch my luck today. It's not even going to be a lapwing. There is, however, impala. No sign of lapwings. Always good. Let's just check. You never know. Is there a baby? The first baby impala seen last year was in this very spot. Oh! Red-crested koran. There. Here we go. Yay! Red-crested koran. Another one for the list. The suicide bird with that very distinct mating display. What else was the other one, Eggsy? Ah, the white-backed vulture. Oh, there's a lilac-crested. Go for it, Eggsy. Go, go, go. There. Got it. There we go. Well done, Eggsy. It's a very highly mobile lilac-crested roller. There it goes. Well done, Eggs. It counts. We're claiming it. It was on camera.
There's another one.
Oh, well, maybe that one's not flying so much. Oh, is it? Oh, it is. Well done. There we go. That lilac-breasted roller. Well done. It's even the common birds that are... that one's going to be too quick. It's a dove. They fly very fast. Okay. Well, we try. Well, we got one short grass bird, which is, of course, the koran. Now, I've just discovered something which I now probably... should have known beforehand on my bird app that it actually has a list making capability. So we're trying to keep up to date. Now, of course, we're going to hit a lot of birds in this area as soon as these gwarri bushes start start fruiting and attract lots and lots of birds. At the same time, I'm always just looking for that first baby impala of the season, and this is a good area to look. Search for our feathered friends. Let's go to the furry trio with Jamie.
The furry trio indeed, because Hosanna has come out from next to the lodge fence and has rejoined his mum and sister. There he is there, looking very full and very content, in my opinion, with his little nick out of his left ear. And then his sister lying up to the right, picking up whatever scraps she can get that her mom has dropped. She seems to have managed to get luck. She's got lucky, though. She's managed to get something that is hidden in the grass that her mom has missed. And then the queen herself snacking on what remains of the Inyala's head. Now that obviously was the part left for last. There we go. All in all, a really, truly special scene with the royal family of Juman. I'm sorry, I'm speaking very, very softly. There are guests right next to me, and I don't want to disturb them in any way. We're just going to whisper our way through this sighting. You can see the flies that had obviously gathered around the head while it was on the ground are now buzzing around her. And just like that, a young Inyala is finished off between the three leopards. Now, I do think there's a very good chance that they might even move off before we finish this afternoon. I mentioned earlier that that might have been the last few moments that we got to spend with them. There are other people on their way to the sighting, so as soon as they get here, then we are going to be leaving. I've lost one now. It's behind the termite. Oh, he's behind the termite mound. Thanks, Chandra. I was so busy watching the other two, I got distracted. Oh, there he goes. Is he going to go back towards that genet, I wonder? Or have the two cubs lost interest? I'm sure they know it's still there. They've probably spent... angry Ellie, somewhere. I just heard an elephant trumpeting furiously. Well, they will have spent their morning probably terrorizing that poor thing and trying to get at it. Now it looks as though he might be heading back in that direction. No. Changed his mind, he's gone off to go and lie a little bit away from mom and sister. It's amazing to watch the development and how much more independent these cubs have become over the last few years. Oh, sorry, last few months. Let me just reposition, sorry, it will make life a little bit easier. We're just going to reposition. I'm going to move around a little bit just so that I'm not on top of the other vehicle, or vice versa, so that we can actually talk without worrying too much about disturbing them. Let me see if I can find a position where we can have a view of all three of them. Oh, goodness, well pointed out, Chandra. I'm glad I didn't land on that. That would have been most unfortunate. Okay. And we'll settle with here for now. Chandra, by the way, just pointed out that I was about to drive through Karula's scat, which would be nearly as bad as driving through a lion's scat. In fact, it would be really, truly almost as unpleasant. They are pretty much as stinky as lion's scat, and the scent doesn't stick around for as long, but it comes quite close. Now, there's the little prince. I know that Brent was discussing earlier this morning on the Sunrise Safari the fact that he has lost his cub-like features. And he's looking more and more like an adult leopard. And he really, truly does, doesn't he? He doesn't look nearly as fluffy. I think the same probably applies to his sister, but I think it's just the shape that Hosanna. Yes, I see how alert you are, little one. You're so on the ball. Little Shungile was picked up already on the fact that there was a male bushbuck moving about around the lodge. See the interest in her body language. This is one of the reasons why, one of the ways that we see the female cubs becoming more and more independent quicker than the males. And that level of interest that she's showing. She's not nearly big enough to hunt a male bushbuck just yet. But she's thought about it. She really looked like her... She looked like her sister there. Her older sister. She looked like Tani. Speaking of the development of the gorgeous leopard cubs, Zach, you wanted to know how old these cubs are and when they will reach maturity and when they will be independent. Zach, they are 9.5 months old. They were born on the 2nd of February, which is probably one of the most specific leopard birth dates that we have ever had, just in terms of the fact that Brent managed to see them when they were just a few hours old. Oh, she will become independent faster than her brother, or sooner than her brother. That's just the way it works with female and male leopards. What are you doing? One, you're going to go and pick a fight with your brother? No, just lie right next to him. Really gives a nicer comparison of size. And sorry, Zachary, I wasn't quite finished with your question. In terms of age, Shungile will be around 18 or so months, or maybe just a little bit older, and Hosanna will probably be around 2 years old when he leaves his mum, but he'll stick around his natal range for quite a long period of time. So there'll be a considerable difference between the development of these two gorgeous leopard cubs. Nice, we don't often get to see them lying together like this. Michael, you want to know, when the time comes, how will Shungile know that it's time to leave Karula, and how will she know which portion of her territory to take? It's a difficult one, because it doesn't necessarily work that the female sort of gives up a portion of her territory. What essentially starts to happen is mother and daughter start to come into conflict more and more frequently, and it's a sort of organic wave. It has an organic way of developing. So Shungile will start spending more and more time in one part of the area that she's grown up in and expand and sort of push the boundaries of her territory out from there and slowly but surely take over a portion of her mother's territory. And it can actually almost be not aggressive in that they physically fight, but they can hiss and snarl at each other a little bit. How will she know that it's time? It happens differently with each individual leopard, and it's when they feel ready, almost in a way like human beings. It depends upon the individual. And what will happen over the course of the next few months is that Shungile will become more and more independent. She'll move away from her mom more frequently. She'll start making kills of her own. She'll still remain affectionate with her mother and her brother, but she'll just spend more and more time away from them, as will her son, actually. They just have to grow in... They just grow in leaps and bounds. But as to how she knows, well, that's a secret that only Shungile will be able to find out when she's ready. I'm not quite sure what triggers the switch and what severs that final connection between mom and daughter, or son and daughter. And once she's out, that's that. She might encounter her mom every now and again, and if her mom's feeling generous, she might even share kills with her. But we've seen with Shadow and we've seen with Tundi, both of whom are Karula's older daughters and on the boundary, on either side of Karula's territorial boundary, it is not always entirely friendly. We've seen Karula and Shadow growling at each other, Tundi and Shadow growling at each other. It's just an interesting way that leopards go about, and they really, truly are a solitary creature. While our leopard cubs nap away, well, not quite nap, but lie up and rest and digest their full bellies of food, let's go across to Byron for an update on his walk.
So look at this, everybody. This is very, very interesting. This is a Transvaal gardenia. And what's happened here is the elephant have devastated this tree. But what's very interesting, and this happened fairly recently by the looks of things, by the soil and that around here, didn't happen too long ago, but I would say in the winter. And the elephants do this so that they can feed on the roots. So they've dug up and pushed over this tree, and it shows you how incredibly powerful they are to get to the roots where all the nutrients in the tree are, and that's what they fed on. But what's interesting is what's happened here is this top part, or this large branch of here, is clearly broken off completely and is dead. But if you have a look through the rest of the tree and through the back, you can still see a lot of green leaves. You see that? So what's actually happened is the tree has been pushed over, but some of the stems, and if you look down, you might see some around, but some of them are still firmly planted in the ground. Some roots are still getting nutrients, and the tree is still alive. So the section of the tree is still alive, even though some parts of it has died, and these branches that have been broken off, but there is still parts of it that are still alive. Now this is wonderful because it does create an entire ecosystem, or mini ecosystem, for a lot of other animals. It's very thick, so there's probably a lot of insects in that living inside there under this thicket. You might get scrub hares coming and looking for shelter, little antelope species. A lot of animals will come and hide in here. So it's actually wonderful that something like this, even though it looks devastating that the elephants have done this, but there is still a lot going on within this area and within this little micro ecosystem. So it's very interesting to see. We haven't found too many birds or anything while we've been on our walk. We're still in search of that woodland kingfisher. Nothing yet, but the competition's still on. We know they're out there. We just need to try and find them. Let's see what else we can find while we're walking around. There was some impala running about earlier on the clearings. We've been looking for scorpions too, but for some reason we haven't been able to find any. Even though the other night we did see one, or was it last night? Yeah, last night saw one in a tree, but we've been trying to look under logs and little stones, but we haven't been able to find any just yet. Let's see what else we can find here. Little droppings over here. Let's have a look here. I wonder if this isn't a little steenbok, perhaps. Let's see. Oh, young impala. You think young impala, yeah. Looks like, because there's so many of them now, a small steenbok would only have probably one little midden or one little area that'll drop its dung. And often the steenbok also actually can cover the dirt up. And now, having a look at all the tracks around here, we can see it is impala. And the smaller little droppings that we can find are probably just younger impala, which is quite interesting. But there's a lot of dung around there, so that's definitely impala. No other antelope that in such large quantities around here in these clearings that would drop such small dung. So it's definitely impala. Let's see anything else. Saw some hyena tracks earlier, and I know we've been struggling to see hyena for some time, and I wonder if it's not because, my theory is possibly because there's been such a lot of lion activity, I would say. You know, the Birmingham males have been around, the Nkuma pride's been around, but I think with those males, and even though they've been killing a lot, I think because the lions are around, the hyenas are a bit nervous, and they tend to stay on neighboring properties. But every now and then they do move through. They were definitely seeing their tracks from the evenings, walking through, trying to scavenge, but I think they're moving out fairly quickly so that they don't get seen by lions. Because if lions do find them, it could cause some... And speaking of hyena, have a look here. Let's see. This looks like hyena dung, everyone. Very, very white. And this does look like hyena dung. The reason I say that is because the hyenas, when they're scavenging, they feed on a lot of bone. So the dung turns white very, very quickly because of the high calcium and phosphorus in the bone. And that causes the dung to turn white very, very quickly. So that's another sign that they are around. This is quite old. It's been broken up a bit, but it is a sign nonetheless. Always nice to look out for those little signs of animals that might be around that you'd be looking for. I'm still so happy that Jamie got to see that genet during the day. That's incredible. Can't wait to hear about it when we get back to camp. Find out exactly what that genet was doing. Stanley, you want to know, how do termites book a site for a termite mound or for a home? Let's have a look over here, Stanley. Let's see. There's a little termite mound over here, and usually what they do is the termites, so for one thing, okay, what happens in a colony, you've got the large queen, and the queen will get to about that size, very, very large. She just lays thousands of eggs daily, and then you have the worker termites, and that basically keep the termite mound active. So they provide food for the termites, they provide, they build the whole mound. You also have soldiers which protect the termite mound. When it rains, however, you get these alates. Now, alates are little flying or winged termites. Sorry, someone's crawling on me. We find little winged termites. Now, those termites, as it rains, they leave the colony, and their sole purpose is to go and start a new colony. So what happens is they'll fly into an area, usually find an area where the soil is probably soft from the rain that is currently falling, and what they then do is they start burrowing down, and then one of those termites will become the queen, and she will start to lay eggs, and the colony will begin. But they do need a lot of moisture. That is very, very important. The soil needs to be quite soft, and there needs to be food around. So an area like this, there is a lot of dead plant material or trees around here, so there is places to find food. The soil is probably fairly soft, even though it doesn't look like it from here. This is an old termite mound. This is very, very hard. So I wouldn't be surprised if this is no longer active. I don't see any sign of termites at the moment. But and then what happens is, with that moisture, there needs to be a very shallow water table so that they are able to get moisture underground. And the reason for that is they use the moisture to obviously, the termites need the water. And then what they do is they use a mixture of saliva, feces, and the soil. And they'll mix it all together to form this hard structure, or the soil structure that they then build the termite mound out of. And over time, it becomes harder and harder. So Stanley, to answer your question in a nutshell, it's basically they need soft soil, food in the area, moisture, and those are probably the most important things termites need to select an area where they can find a termite mound. And Ashley, you asked why would termites leave the mound, and the reason for that is probably the water table has dropped, there's not a lot of moisture around, and maybe food resources in the area have depleted, so they then have to then move on and find another colony, or start another colony. I've seen something interesting just behind us, hang on a second, there we go, look at these beautiful yellow butterflies. Oh, we've got, hang on. What are these? They look almost like broad-bordered grass yellows, but hang on, yeah, I think so. They've got little black tips when they are flying, but then when they land, you don't see it. They close their wings. Beautiful, beautiful little yellow butterflies. And there's another little orange one sitting on the branch here too. Seeing lots of yellow flowers on this bush. This is a raisin bush, so a lot of little flowers on here at the moment, and that's what's attracting all these butterflies. I'm not sure what that little orange butterfly is over there. There are so many different species, and I've tried my best to learn as many butterflies as possible, but it is fairly difficult. And as I mentioned earlier, there are still people out there that are studying butterflies that don't even know all the species. They can probably categorize them, but a lot better than I can, but they're not entirely sure what they are. That's fascinating. Now, Kathy, you want to know what the difference between a moth and a butterfly is. Now, one of the main differences is the moths are generally nocturnal. You do get day moths, but generally nocturnal, and butterflies are a lot more colorful than moths. I'm trying to think. I don't believe the moths pollinate flowers like the butterflies do, but I could be wrong. I'm trying to think what else. Sure, Kathy, I'm trying to think. It's off the top of my head, those are the major differences between moths and butterflies. I have to try to find out if there are some others. Let's have a look. Some termites under there. I don't want to disturb them too much. Just having a look if there are any scorpions or anything. I heard an elephant. Sounded quite far away in the distance, a few hundred meters. I don't think we'll be able to see them. And let's come have a look. I think over here, I think Herbert spotted something. Brandon, you wanted to know if butterflies migrate. I don't think they do, Brandon. Not as far as I know in this area. I think there are seasonal movements with certain butterflies, and also all depends on food and water availability. But it is interesting how someone was explaining to me how butterflies will move through different areas, different times of the day. You'll get specific butterfly species that will go and find food or pollen on certain branches or trees, rather, different levels of mountains in certain areas, and then all depends on the time of the day. You can find specific species of butterflies on those plants at that specific time of day, which is very, very interesting. Paul, you want to know if butterflies have any predators? Let's see here. What have we got here? Oh, this little guy. Now, I know these little guys very, very well. This is called a velvet ant. Well spotted, Herbert. Let's see if I can get him out here a little bit. Just come so low. Now, this little velvet ant is actually part of the wasp family. Look at that. Wonderful, isn't it? Now, it doesn't fly, but here it is. Here, this little guy will give you a very, very nasty sting. I'm bringing him around this side, Vim, this way. Here we go. This side, yeah. Here we go. Now look at these beautiful colors on this little velvet ant. Stop there for us. They've got a very, very nasty sting. I've been stung by one of these. They can actually sting you right through your clothes. And there it goes, a little velvet ant. And as I said, it is part of the wasp family. So that's really, really nice. Have a look here. Wow. What has happened here? I wonder if this little lilac-breasted roller was attacked by something, perhaps. Look at these beautiful feathers, everyone. Look at that. Look at the color. Now, I'm sure this is actually meant to be good luck in some cultures. If you find some lilac-breasted roller feathers, and if you keep them, put them in your hat. So I'll see if there's a really nice one that I might keep. So lots going on around this area in the clearing. Anyway, while I collect lilac-breasted roller feathers, let's head back to Brent and get an update from him.
Well, there we go, another bird for our list. Not one we've seen too often with a lack of water around, but it is a juvenile fish eagle. And it is at Sydney's waterhole. And here we go, keeping a good eye out on if there are any fish to possibly feed on. Now, there's some guinea fowl as well, some helmeted guinea fowl. So there we go, that's another one. We're getting there very slowly, but I think we might have possibly given ourselves a bit of a mountain to climb for a sunset safari with a bit of wind, but a mountain we shall attempt. Now, I saw something absolutely stunning while we were sitting here, and I'm going to hopefully be able to find them again. I saw a little family of crested Franklins cross the road, but with the smallest little babies. And I'm hoping they haven't moved too far. Cross just down here,
Whoopsie daisy, and sorry everybody, it seems as though Brent has disappeared off your screen. It's the joys of a live safari. You just never know what to expect around the next corner. Unfortunately, sometimes the surprise is a signal dip, which was unexpected in Brent's case. So you are back with me in the vehicle, and wonders upon wonders, we have not have to leave. Our patience has outmatched the other vehicles, and we find ourselves with the leopards once again. I was just repositioning to bring you a view of Shungile and Hosana, at which point they got up and moved. A point that has not gone unnoticed by the local area's impala herd that are currently watching with great trepidation and alarm calling. I hate to tell you this, impala, but you're a little bit behind the times. Let's just listen and see them bark. I love that sound. Usually because it means we're about to find a leopard or a lion. Last time. Oh, I keep talking over her. My timing's terrible. Look, 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 look. Look at her on the left. Did you see that? Oh, she just... The baby just kicked. The baby just... It's kicking in response to her alarm call. Did anybody else just see that? That was so cool. The baby just... The fetus just kicked. You okay there, Jandre? You're joining in the alarm calls. Watch her belly. I know that she's contracting when she calls, but look, you can actually see the slight protuberance on her, sort of close towards her hip bone. I don't know if that baby's going to do it again. That was so cool. I didn't imagine that. Please can somebody tell me whether or not I'm going completely mad? I'm almost certain I saw that baby move, and quite significantly. Obviously she's contracting, so that's not what I mean. I mean the muscles of her diaphragm are contracting to create that barking sound. So that's not what I mean, and not what I meant. I promise you I saw an angle protrusion come sort of out of her belly for a moment there. That was so cool. Thank you, yes, I'm not going crazy. Thank you for all of you sending through that I'm not completely loopy and that you did actually see the baby move. How cool is that? How absolutely awesome is that? They're going to be out very soon. Let's just watch them for a little bit longer and then we'll go back to the leopards. I'm really chuffed. I've been speaking about the possibility of seeing the fetuses move in these very pregnant impala, and I haven't had a chance to get it on camera this season. So the fact that we manage now is awesome. Hey, big girl, you're going to be having that baby any day now. It's practicing running already, huh? It's going to do well. Shame. She's making sure that everybody knows that the leopards are there. Out of a deep concern. Oh, she's being joined by all of the rest of the impala on quarantine. A chorus of barks, and now I can hear them. I just can't see them. There's dwarf mongoose alarm calling as well. I don't know where those are, though. They must be out of sight. Yes, girl, there are definitely leopards there. Amazing that instinct to alert everybody in the area to the fact that there's a predator. It is quite selfless in a way, because she knows that the leopards are there. Now, she just would have to move off without telling anybody else. But she does tell everybody else, because of course her safety is dependent on the safety of the rest of the herd. Oh, I've got goosebumps from the fact that we saw that movement. Yes, girl. There's leopards there. Okay. Speaking Speaking of leopards, I think let's go back across and see what they're up to. I think they've, now that it's got a little bit cooler, they might be full of the joys of spring. Now, while we do trundle away towards the leopards, let's head over to Bryron so that he can tell you what his plans are for the rest of this afternoon.
Alright, so we've been walking around seeing if we can find anything else. I found some old elephant dung. I'm just having a look to see if I can't find some interesting insects around here. Found a few little dung beetles just hiding in there, everyone. Can you see that? And we're actually not too far from where Jamie is at the moment. We can hear the Impala alarm calling. I wonder if they don't perhaps see Karula. It's possibly what's happening, not too far from us. As I said, you know, at the moment the sound's traveling quite a lot. We heard those elephants this morning with the lions, and they were very far from us, probably at least 2 kilometers away. So it's amazing how the sound is still carrying through the bush. Usually in winter it's easier to hear things further and further away. As the summer comes, the bush thickens up a little bit, the air's a bit thicker, the sound doesn't travel as far. But anyway, we've had a wonderful afternoon. It's great to see the buffalo and the elephant on foot. I'm glad you got to see some of that with us, especially those ellies at the end. And it's been nice looking for these little insects and that, and spending time out here. It's been a lovely afternoon. I'm going to say goodbye. So from myself and VM on camera, thank you very much, VM. And of course, Herbert, it's been a wonderful afternoon with you. We'll see you tomorrow morning again. Let's head back to Brent and get an update from him. Goodbye, everyone.
We have the exquisite, tiny, blue waxbill as another bird for our list. Now, they're getting ready to finish foraging and now head off into the trees to roost. I've just heard some impala alarming, so we're going to just quickly shoot up into that tree. There we go. And there's the fine figure cut of a steppe eagle. You see the long gait that extends to the end of the eye. I wonder if that's shadow, or would Tingano have come back already? It sounds like there's an impala alarm calling around Sandy Patch or Aubrey's Road Junction. Or could it be? Now, we haven't given up on the bird. I could never forgive myself if I didn't follow up on alarm calls. Not those impala, by the way. You can see they were very relaxed. You're holding on, eggs. Whee! Oh, big bump. Slow down. Hoppa! So it sounded like they're probably about 200-300 meters away from us, and they were going ballistic, or bananas. So they've definitely spotted something. Whee! Now, the one thing we're sure it's not is an African wild dog, but the wonderful thing about being on a live safari is it could be a cheetah, it could be a lion, it could be a leopard. Okay. Whee! Oh, bug in the ear. That's not good while I'm driving. Now, during summer months, we do get beetles and bugs in our ear, and they can be extremely painful. Now, the trick to getting rid of them is to actually just insert olive oil into your ear. Here we go. I just need to listen. Those impala looking there, there's other impala in front of me that are still alarming. There we go, yeah, that's it. I wonder what is there. Hold on. Now, I'm just judging from their behavior, it's gonna be a cat, lion or leopard. I mean, there's always a chance it could be a cheetah, but highly unlikely in this area. Leopard.
wonder who it is. Oh! Oh, bird, courser, gone. Leopard, monster. Is that Tingana? Oh, is that it? I'm not sure which leopard it is yet. There it is, big male leopard. I'm going to pop out there now. Oh, he's been, I think it's Tingana. It looks like he's been digging in a warthog hole. But it doesn't look like he's been successful this time. Station's located, a big one, Nuna Ingwe, off Aubrey's Road. Animals Mobile, west in the block at the moment, towards Sandy Patch. So I think it is Tingana. Just judging, well, he doesn't have the exclusive rights to digging out things, but he is very well known for it. Oh dear, he's taking us on a ride. I'm just trying to figure out how to get around this termite mound now. This is quite a thick area. Okay, Eggsy, you ready? Okay, you good? Oh, let's just have a quick look. Let's try and get a positive identification on him. He is on the move and he's looking quite hungry. Now, I don't know how hungry Tingana was looking this morning. And it's unusual for him to head to that side and then come back. There we go. Okay, we're going to give you one last view of him. He's stopped there. And then we can go back across to Jamie while I try to get into a better position. But how exciting. I'm pretty sure it's Tingana, but I'll find out in a second. But let's go check what's happening with Karula and Jamie.
All in all, our Saturday Catterday was less successful than our Sunday Catterday. Hello, girl. And now? Yeah. Yes, Shungile is there. We now definitely don't have a view. Oh, goodness, sorry. I've somehow accidentally turned my game drive communications on a little bit too loud, and I now feel slightly deafened. Look at these impala. Despite all of the alarm calling, look here. On their way right past. Is this a different group? Is this a group that hasn't quite realized that this is quite a dangerous spot to come walking past at the moment? They're definitely on their way to go and have a drink. I don't think Karula's going to do anything. So far, she's had about 3 opportunities today, and she obviously knows exactly when to try and when not to. I'm not going to question her expertise. She's definitely, definitely far more experienced in this area than I am. In fact, I'm not experienced in this area at all, in terms of being a leopard and hunting things. So I'm going to take her decision as for what it is, that she was not going to catch the animals that walked past her. I think she knows exactly when to risk wasting her energy and when not to. That whole sentence, in fact, that entire thought pattern didn't make any sense. I'm sorry. Hosanna watching the impala wander past. I nearly asked you where Shungile was. I love it when they do this. Apparently Hosanna was doing it to Brent this morning. Hosanna's not being the friendly one this afternoon. This afternoon it's Shungi's turn. Sorry, if I can't go anywhere now. Karula's on her way. Where's she off to? She's been spotted, and now we're treated to another chorus of impala alarm calls. Immediately that white tail starts flicking. Supposedly the leopard's way of saying, acknowledging that it's been seen, and essentially giving up the chase. This code is a little bit slower on the uptake than the other one was. Now, the one thing about alarm calling Impala is that they will often alert other predators to the presence of predators in an area. And of course, that was one of the ways that Brent found this male leopard. Let's go and see if we can find out exactly who it is.
There we go. We've managed to get a good look at him. I'm pretty certain it's Tingana. He is quite highly mobile to the north, so I'm worried he might cross into Buffalo's Hook, but we're going to stick with him for as long as possible. And he's been digging in termite mounds. There we go. He's going to stop and we can have a look. There we go. Look at that. You can see how dirty his face is. He's been going underground and trying to find a warthog or an aardvark for dinner. So, and being very Tingana in his movements, moving from termite mound, checking for any that are active with warthogs, which is one of his favorite foods. He is such a beautiful specimen. So, isn't that incredible? That leopard number 4, there we go. Maybe he's going to give us a call. Or is he just going to scent Mark? No sawing yet. Probably if you look at that indentation in his belly, he's quite hungry. No, I just need to see where he's going to go. Also, makes quite a lot of sense that Tingana would be scent marking in this area. Mr. T, where are you taking us? Oh, have you spotted something? Now, we were there bird watching just now. There were impala not too far from here, but on the other side of those thickets. Oh, here's a magnificent specimen of a leopard. Okay, off we continue. He's changed direction slightly again. Oh, that's a big stump. Hoppa! Jumped up. Okay. It's getting thick again. Well, hi Ben. Now Ben's wondering how do these leopards get their names? Well, Tingana actually means the shy one. He's a bit of an exception to the rule how leopards normally get their names in the Sabi Sands. It depends where. So generally, different lodges, different areas might have slightly different call. Up here in the northern Sabi Sands, what we do is, if it's a leopard that's seen within your area regularly, we'll generally put forward a few names from the different lodges, and then at the head rangers meeting, the head rangers will decide. And well, in Tingana's case, he arrived as an adult, and a very shy adult male. So he could have come, we're not sure where he came from initially. So when he was first seen, and because he was so shy, the guides who first saw him, there he is, gave him the name Tingana. And you can see, as long as you don't put too much pressure and you drive carefully and respectfully around these animals, they quickly learn that you're not a threat. I mean, he literally has not even looked back at us since we found him. Okay, now, as I've said many times before, it's very important to try get into the right place, to try predict what's going to happen ahead. Now, I'm trying to remember what I saw as I was driving through this area earlier. I saw impala, I saw waterbuck all through here. So I know where he's going, but it's always a risk now because we still are quite far away from where I want to be, and he could obviously see something and change his mind. So we've got to sort of weigh up the gamble of whether it's worth trying to shoot up ahead of him to where we know the potential prey species are, or to stick with him while he takes us on an adventure. There we we go. Oh, watch out there, eggs. Got it. Okay. Now, what I'm trying to do also is just double check up ahead always to try to see, because I'm higher, if I can see if there's any potential prey species, which will then prompt me to possibly move a little bit differently. And at the moment, I haven't seen anything, but we are, what we would say, deep in a block at the moment. We're right in the middle of a thick block. Okay, so now I've got a clear view. Now we just saw that step eagle. It's still there up in the tree, but I'm gonna see, there's the tree that it was in. We're gonna go around now because I know there's some potential prey species. I'm gonna keep an eye on him, but I am gonna go a little bit further from him. Now, I don't wanna be driving behind him as he comes across impala or potential prey. They might be attracted to the noise of my vehicle. Unlikely, because the animals here are so used to it. Secondly, we want to be in the right spot in case action goes down. So we don't want to be stuck behind him. We want to be, so it looks like he might have spotted something. We don't want to be stuck behind him. We want to be where the action's going to end rather than where it begins. So he's just stopped now. I just want to see what he's going to do next. Is he coming? He's carrying on back towards us. Okay, no, we're in the right spot. So he is going to pop out into the open in about 40 seconds. And I want to be in that open before he is my plan. Okay, this could be exciting. So there were impala and waterbuck right here when we were bird watching our way up here. Okay, you got it. Okay, so we're through. And can you still see him? There he is. So now we're right spot, using, which a leopard always does. I'm going to get eggs you now.
Whoops, it seems as though we've lost Brent, but that's okay, we've still got leopards as well, and just listen to the sounds at the moment. I was hoping the bushbuck was going to keep calling as well. It's been such an amazing evening spent with the royal family. Oh, there it was. A deep booming bark. Watch the behavior, because these leopards are going to come out into quarantine, so I'm not going to rush after them in the thicket. Watch the behavior of the impala as they start to trot off after the leopards. Make sure that they can keep an exact eye on where those leopards are going. Make sure that they're not sneaking up on them, because of course it's not the leopard you see that gets you if you're an impala out here, it's the one you don't. So once they have spotted a leopard, they're reluctant to let it get out of their eyeline. You know what's wrong with me this afternoon? Okay. Deep booming bark again. Bushbuck in Inga's garden, I think. Or just next to Inga's garden. Okay, let's go and catch up with these leopards. Might have a beautiful view next to on quarantine. Leopards going to go. Impala racing across quarantine. Unfortunately, the wind seems to be picking up, so we won't be able to pick up the sounds of the bush this evening as well as we would might otherwise. They're going to walk right next to my car. That's so cool. How cool is that? That's my car, and that is Karula walking in front of it. That's awesome. Sorry, I got a little bit of personal joy from that. Marching along the fence line of where we live. So cool. Absolutely awesome. Creeping off in towards the south. Once they start moving into some dense vegetation, then I'm probably going to leave them to go about their evening business. And just because it is starting to get dark, she's got the two cubs on the move, we'll go back to that jennet and see if it can't see it coming down. I'm going to go a little bit further ahead towards these, just past these impala. Cheers. Thanks, Ev. Let's see if we can get another shot of the impala and the leopards. Which way is she going to go? I just don't want to chase the impala myself, which is why I'm giving them a little bit of room. The impala chorus. Sounds like a band. Hey! Hey! Get out of the garden! Okay, the leopard cub is now in Inga's. Let's just move forward slightly. Watch the impala all running. Hey! Out! Out, you little mischief! Oh, it was on the outside of the fence. I thought it had... Unless that's cub number... I'm not sure which... Look at all of these impala. Sorry, there's so much going on. They're streaming across to make sure that those leopards are not going to come back and circle them. See, they're running at the leopards. How cool is that? Sorry, if we don't start up, we're going to lose these leopards. I love scenes like this. It gives you such a lovely idea about the interaction. Okay, all right. Panic! Panic, leopard, panic! Here we go. Then one brave ram and one brave female. Gives you a really nice idea, now the ram's going forward, of an interaction between predator and prey without it having to be a hunt, essentially. Yes, impalalas. You're right, there's leopards. I wonder how many times Karula walks past our gate. Many, I imagine. Okay. Now this is probably going to... Oh! Okay, I've checked... Oh, goodness. Just called in hyenas at Gallagher Pan. She's going to jump on him. I'm not quite sure where Karula went. Oh. Hi, girl. Two little mischiefs. This must be their favorite time of the day. In my imagination, at least. Their favorite time of the day. Going on a walk with Mum. Before she leaves them behind in a place where they know they have to kind of stay and it's kind of boring. But when they're traveling with Mom, it must be so exciting. There's so many things to do and play with and Mom's tail to stalk. It must be the most exciting time for them in their day. Get to pretend pretend that they are fully grown independent adults, perhaps, sauntering along the road. imitating already that leopard relaxed waltz of a fully grown leopard. Right, it sounds as though Brent has left the leopard. I think he's found signal, though. I'm going to leave these leopards. I'm going to go and look at the hyena. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent.
Well, when I thought the birding was over, we've got a special gift at the end of the birding light, and it's a roosting ground hornbill. Oh, and it's a taking off ground hornbill. Isn't that absolutely gorgeous? Massive birds, one of the rarest birds around. It's just things like a changed roost, or the rarest hornbill species around. Oh, here we go. So there's two there now. They just moved to a different tree. And there they are, silhouetted against the fading light. And just, can you zoom so I can try sex them quickly there, please, eggs? That's a male. You can see that prominent casque. Looks actually both of them are males. Yeah, both of them are males. Now that's not uncommon. Quite often there will be, it'll be a father and son, and they'll both be looking out for mom, who's probably stuck in a nest at the moment. And they're very long-lived birds, live for about 40 years. Oh, you got an itch. Beautiful. They are such stunning birds. One of the really important birds, and if you look at an ecosystem as a whole, they are what you call an indicator species. So ground hornbill presence is an indicator of a healthy ecosystem. They're one of the first species to disappear when an ecosystem is not healthy. There we go, wonderful bird. Now, like the other hornbill species, mom will stay on the nest, and they're very, very, very specific nesting requirements, big hollow jackalberries. So that's another problem. And they're also very finicky nesters. If they get disturbed, a mother might not nest for 2 or 3 years. And the young ones will generally stay with their parents for up to 15 years. And quite often it's the males that move, and the mom is often replaced as the head of the female head of the family by one of her daughters. Okay, we've done a bit of a sneak. Here we go. Oh no. Here we go. Oops, sorry. Sorry, guys. Okay, well, off they go. And always awesome to see ground hornbills. One of the really, really key indicator species. Now, one of the other key indicator species that of a healthy ecosystem in Africa is something that a ground hornbill eats. And who can guess what that healthy indicator of the ecosystem is and is often eaten by ground hornbills? Let me know if you know what that species I'm thinking about is. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Now, we heard on the radio that there were some hyenas, and I know Jamie was on her way to try get there. Oh yes, we got interrupted by Mr. Tingana, who has unfortunately gone to Buffalo's Hook. He went straight across the boundary just after we had that signal breakup. And I was talking about, in the summer months we often get bugs in our ears, and the beetles can often be quite painful as they crawl into your ear. And the best medicine for that is olive oil. So what happens if you pour olive oil into your ear, the beetle or bug or fly or whatever can no longer breathe, that it suffocates. So the damage they do is actually they scratch on your eardrum. And another thing they can do, especially if it's an insect that's able to make noise. Now, you wouldn't believe how painful and how loud just a beetle walking on your eardrum is. So olive oil in, and if you don't have olive oil, if you're out in the field, I mean, I've in desperation once, it was so painful, I've used car oil. But any form of a viscous liquid, I suppose you could use a syrup. A mission to get out, but you could use any sort of viscous liquid. You pour it into your ear, and that suffocates the beetle, and then your ear expels it itself. And so always good to know these things, because a bug in the ear is an incredibly painful experience. Now, Zoe's wondering if I have any tricks to remove ticks. I do. I'm actually quite lucky. I don't get bitten by as many ticks as Steph and Jamie. They seem to absolutely love Steph or Jamie. We'll go walking. I'll have 4 bites. Jamie will have 400. But no, the best way, especially with pepper ticks, because often you can't see them, is when you get back from a walk, is, I don't know, it's baby oil, and you put that over there, and it works the same principle as olive oil. You can also put a baby oil in your ear, and what it does, it suffocates those ticks. They can't breathe and they fall off. Now, the only time you really use baby oil is if you've walked into a nest. And I've, as a kid, according to my mother, I just remember being manhandled, and I was playing in some old thatching grass. Now, thatching grass is wonderful because if it's powered really high, you can make a slide out of it. So it was old thatching grass that had been removed from the roof of a lodge and was going to be disposed of, burnt at some point. But before there, I managed to get into that thatching grass. And it was piled high, and we don't need slides out in the bush. As bush kids, we entertain ourselves with whatever we can find. So we used to get some serious speed down there, and I did not know there was a pepper tick nest in there. So my mom actually was, I now remember why she was so furious, or well, not so much furious, but we were about to go to a wedding. The head ranger and one of the ladies who worked in the lodge were about to get married, and sort of 20 minutes before bath time, get these little rug rats as... Why is there so much dust here? Oh, it's an elephant. get these little rugrats as clean as possible before the wedding starts. There you go, let's find an Ellie. Oh, there we go, some out in the open in the road. And, well, what happened is, before we go to the elephants, let me just finish this quickly. She came to fetch me, and apparently I only used to wear underpants. There was no need for many clothes when I was younger. I was covered, literally it looked like someone had thrown sort of this reddish black paint on me, but it was moving. And my mother said she couldn't see my skin, so she dumped me in lots of baby oil. There is a harsher one, you can use paraffin. Also works, but it also burns. Oh, lovely, nice herd of Ellies. There seem to be the Ellies are moving back again. I was actually on my way to the male lions. Oh, look, those two boys at the back there look like they're going to be sparring. I think they're the ones who are causing all the dust earlier. I hope you haven't chased the lions, Ellies. Make it a little bit more difficult for me to find them. Now, we're not going to put any lights on these elephants. I know it's a bit dark, but Ellies aren't the biggest fan of lights. Here you can see the Juma pan light on the other side. Oh, there's some Ellies that are more out in the open up ahead. We'll go to those ones. Hi, Ellies. Nice to have you back. Do love the smell of elephants, and actually it's the smell of elephant dung. And so as I get older and I think back, my poor mother must have had quite the job. We didn't wear shoes either, and in northern Zululand at Pinda there is red clay, and it actually took about 3 years for our feet to become normal colour. Our bottom of our feet was actually stained with that clay. Here we go. Oh, listen, go to the one in front. I can actually hear it suckling. There they are. Here we go, look at that. Hello, little one. Now I'm trying to see if this is the same herd we saw earlier, but I can't see. I think it is. I think that's the same baby we had on the Sunrise Safari, Eggs. Looks like it. I recognize the mom. Is that lots of little babies in this group? Oh, look at the side on the right here. Other right. Other right. Other right. Quickly, look at him. He's scratching. He's scratching at the tree. Oh, he's so cute. Little one, little boys. Sticking close to mom. I'm just going to wait for the Ellies to... Don't push that onto me, you young hooligan. Now, of course, not trying to push it onto me. Just moving it so I can get access to the fresh green grass that's growing underneath, that's been protected from the other animals. Oh, look at him peeking over the termite mound. Oh, he's having a... There we go. Oof, they move. We're going to do the same. We're going to keep heading towards the male lions, and I'm hoping they're going to give us a show this evening. Now, my plan was always to come to the male lions. I was hoping for a bit of roaring this evening, but I wanted to get some good birding in there. Unfortunately, I think we fell well short of our target. While we make our way towards the supposed king of the jungles, which we all know is not true because lions don't like jungles and elephants are definitely the king, let's go see how Jamie's hunt for hyenas is going.
That's not hyenas. I'm sorry, that's taken me as much by surprise as anybody else. Hello. Hello, Ngumas. You're definitely not hyenas. They must have come in and the hyenas must have run off. Obviously, it is a bit dark and unfortunately we can't spotlight them. But that was quite the surprise. Sorry about that. I thought we were coming to see hyena and we've just bumped into the entire Nkuhuma pride. So there you go. Who have we got here? We had heard that they'd moved from where they were this morning, and because we're trying to avoid tracking them too much at the moment, given that some of them are struggling a little bit in terms of walking, so we haven't been tracking them because they do feel a bit more vulnerable at this time, so we left them. But there we go, we've just bumped into them. As far as I can tell, it is just the Nkuhuma ladies, no sign of any male lions. All six cubs from this morning are here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Wait, five, six, seven. No, that's not possible. That's definitely not possible because two of them have definitely gone to Honesterport. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No, all six cubs are here. That's wonderful. And five females. Awesome. Oh, what a beautiful surprise. It wasn't the hyenas we were going for, but it was the Nkuhuma lions. Just goes to show, you never know what to expect. Let's go look for the hyenas, because it's a little bit dark for us to be sitting with the Nkuhumas without being able to spotlight them. So we're going to leave the lions for now, and we will carry on the search for those missing hyenas. They must have, if the lions came in from this way, which they must have done, they must have chased those hyenas off in this direction. Ha! Huh. Surprise! Okay. If we don't have any luck along here, then we'll go straight back to where that Jennet was and see if we don't have any luck there. For the last few minutes of the... Oh! Sorry. Bump. For the last few minutes of the sunset safari. Hyenas, please. Feels like it's been forever. We were trying to think about it this morning. When was the last time we saw a hyena? And it's been so long that I actually couldn't even say for certain exactly when it was that I last saw a hyena, at least. I have a suspicion it was on Cheetah Plains, but I honestly don't remember. I'm Marcel from Cape Town. Oh, hold on, let's go to Brent.
So, can hear one male's roaring. I'm hoping he's going to start joining him now. So they moved a little bit from where we had them this morning. Who's this? Is this... Here we go. Here goes Tino. So Mfumo started off the roaring. Was this Mfumo? I can't. No, it is Tino. Tino, why were you roaring with your coalition mate? It's very rude. I definitely think they are going to roar again, and in the next little while. So they've moved probably 50 or 60 meters, probably because of the elephants. Wasn't the most enthused lion roar I've ever heard from Mfumo. I can't see Mfumo at the moment. Come on, Tino. Give us a big one. Oh. He gave us a big yaw. I'm trying to say, is that not Mfumo? Just, can you super zoom onto his cheek there? No, it's not. It's Tino. Oh, look at those eyes. Oh, look at those gnashes. Look how he's lifting his nose to the air, sniffing, picking up all the information the wind's bringing with him. You're not going to roar for us now. If they're going to get up, start moving. They might move towards the Nkuhumas. They might not. They might go off on patrol. As it gets darker, it becomes more and more the lion's time, so to speak. Oh, itchy nose. Well, it has been another incredibly cat-filled drive. We are being incredibly spoilt at the moment. Karula, cubs, a surprise Tingana, a surprise Nkuhuma, and now with the big Birmingham boys. Remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv.
if you've got any questions about lions or anything we've seen today for that matter. And also, could someone let me know how many birds we eventually got up to, so I know how much to berate myself this evening. Now, we've got a... I was talking about indicator species in terms of healthy ecosystems and in Africa. And Feline Ferocity says snakes. Well, it is small, and ground hornbills definitely do eat a lot of snakes. But snakes do survive even with human habitation. In some cases, snakes even increase because of... Oh, it's an elephant. In terms of vermin, and you get lots of rats and things around human habitation. Therefore, in quite a lot of cases, snakes can increase. So it's not snakes. But you're on the right track. It's not a reptile. I'll give you that as a clue. Let's go see if we can spot Mfumo. Sounded like he was just around the corner from Tinio. I would say, yep, there we go. So we didn't see him earlier, we could just hear him. Hello, Mfumo. Smelly cat. Now, hopefully you're going to be more prone to roaring than your coalition mate. Giving himself a good clean. He's been spending an incredible amount of time with the Inkahumas recently. It'll be interesting to see if he decides to go off patrolling or visiting the Styx or the Torchwood Pride. Or is he going to hang on a little longer within Kahumas? Oh, grooming is obviously quite an important thing for lions. And all cats for that. Okay, here we go. No, still time to groom. Now, if we look sort of on what would be the back of his knee, so to speak, you can see there, look at all those ticks. It's sort of a little infestation of ticks there. It's in one of those hard to reach spots. No, I must consider how... There we go. He's going to try to lick some of those ticks off there. We'll see them falling. Get those terrible creatures. Well, must be so incredibly infuriating. But I suppose a lion's sort of level of comfort is very different from ours. So, Safari, Ginny, Stuart and Jeffrey think the indicator species might be dung beetles. Well, unfortunately it's not. It's a very good guess though, because if you think about it, a large commercial cattle or goat or sheep farms produce a lot of dung, so the dung beetles are still happy. Okay, well, we're going to sit here patiently hoping the Birmingham boys are going to shatter the quiet of the African night with an impressive roaring display. So while we wait, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Oh, while Brent waits patiently for the lions to roar once again, I'm on my way back to where we saw that genet at the start of the sunset safari. I'm really hoping we're not too late. I think the rush to the hyenas that turned out to be lions may have set us back a little bit in terms of having our chance to see it come down from the tree. But I'm going to try, nevertheless, I'm going to give it a go. Oh, speaking of hyenas, of course, we didn't see any tonight. We saw lions instead. Marcel, sorry, I got interrupted while I was answering your questions about why is it that we hardly ever see hyena here. We used to see them all the time, Marcel. We used to spend hours and hours of our day at the hyena dens around the various areas of Juma. Sorry, I've just got to remember where to go in the dark now. Yeah, this way. We spent a considerable period of time with them. We had quite a large clan. It was easily 20-odd hyena. And then one day, they upped and left and went outside of our traverse area. So, in other words, outside of where it is we're allowed to go. And they haven't been seen very often since. We don't know why they've vanished. One of the predominant theories is that it's because the lions have had their cubs in this area, and they've sort of, the Nkumas have been largely based in this particular place on, sorry, just concentrating here. They've been basically almost immovable from Juma. And I think that's probably why, especially with cubs, they would be more protective than they might otherwise be. You okay there? Sorry, Jandre. There's a tree there. Sorry, I can't see with that light on. At all. Any sign of our little genet? I don't think so. I think we have arrived just that little bit too late. Oh, sorry, excuse me. That took me by surprise. No, I don't see it. We would see the eyes shining at us. Sorry, I'm just scanning the area. I think that genet has taken its opportunity and dashed out of the tree that it was in. It was worth a try. Sorry, I'm just checking along the marula tree. Nope, no sign of it. I'm going to keep looking. It might be somewhere on the ground. You never know. Meantime, let's go back to Brent and his lions.
Oh, he started a roar.
Oh, there we go.
Come on. Stop yawning and give us a proper roar. he had us all fooled there. He gave a good few and he never quite got going to the moo. Got sidetracked with grooming. Maybe he's a millennial lion. Oh, we can hear some of the nocturnal birds starting to get going. Can hear a pearl-spotted owlet in the distance. Really faintly in the distance, we can hear fiery neck nightjar. Good Lord, deliver us. I don't know how they make that out of the fiery neck nightjar's call. Oh, ears are up. Nope, he's going to carry on licking. Oh, come on, Nfumo. Now, I think I might have caught you guys out with that. One of the most important indicator species in a healthy ecosystem. I'll give you guys a little bit longer before I let the cat out of the bag. Of course, it's not a cat.
domestic cats are a sign of a very unhealthy ecosystem. If you have them running around, they are responsible for 80% of the avian extinctions in the last 100 years. Now, a leopard tortoise from James, Richard, Raisa and Michael. I suppose you could say they're an indicator species, but not as an important one. And the only reason the leopard tortoise actually doesn't do too well with too much human habitation is because they taste quite good and they get eaten. But they still survive reasonably well on commercial farms. Well done to Connie, Carla and Nicole. You guys are spot on. It is frogs. Of course, not all species of frogs, but most species of frogs are very, very sensitive to changes in their environment. Now, with any commercial farming, things like fertilizers, pesticides, any change to the water, from fertilizers, pesticides, anything like that, a frog is a very, very, very good indicator, because the slightest change, they absorb almost all those terrible things through their skin. So if there's an area devoid of frogs, oh, you're gonna tease us again. He's just teasing us. But we did also hear another little nocturnal bird calling there. That was a barred owlet. Looks like he's getting stuck into some more, trying to remove some more of those ticks. Well, we're not going to move a muscle, but I'm sure Jamie would love to say goodnight.
What an incredible afternoon it has been. I hope you've all enjoyed it as much as we have, because it really has been a truly special day here on our live safaris. Six cubs from the Nkuhuma Pride, the adults looking to me better. I haven't seen them walking properly, but it's fantastic news that the six cubs are there. Tingana, Karula and her two gorgeous cubs. What a wonderful, wonderful day it has been. I really can't think of any better way to spend my Sunday. And on that note, unfortunately, Sunday has come to an end and it's time for us to say goodbye. So thank you to Jandre for his wonderful camera work. Thank you to all of you for your questions and comments. We'll catch you tomorrow on the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Well, we didn't miss anything, apart from a bit more grooming by Mfumo, the authority. Now, I'm hoping he decides to display his authority with an impressive roar. Oh, he's going back after those ticks, saw him, before the end of the safari. And it's amazing how well that wound is healed. And I know lots of you were quite worried about it, but you've got to realize that this is a hard life out here for lions. And to be the apex predator is not easy, and it's very, very common for them to be completely covered in bites, holes, limping, scratches. That is sort of the way of the male lion. And for me, a male lion without holes and scratches and nicks and cuts and bumps isn't really a male lion, and it's one of the easiest ways to tell with photographs if it's a wild lion or a captive bred lion or a zoo lion. And zoo lions don't look like that. Come on, you've got 2 minutes, and Mfumo, give us a show. I came all the way back here just to hear you roar, so you just better behave now. Look at those eyes. Exquisite creature. Now, of course, we are coming towards the end of the safari. I don't think... Eggs, you think we made it to 20 birds? I'm not sure. I think we were close to 20, which was a good effort in the cloudy, windy weather. We might have to try again on the sunrise safari. 38 is an impressive number that Brian and I put up. And we're going to have to see what we can do. Well, there we go. Thank you very much, Sapraya. 22 species. Not bad for an afternoon sunset safari. We're going to have to do better on the sunrise safari. And hope the big cats don't get in the way. Oh, I'm only joking. We do love seeing the big cats. And we are coming towards the end of the sunset safari. And Informal, the authority, is not playing along. He's supposed to roar right about now. So you don't have to listen to me babble on for the last 30 seconds or so, but it's been absolutely splendid. Thanks to Final Control and to all of you who make it possible and make it so enjoyable for us out there, all your questions. And well done on those of you who got the quizzes right today. There were some slightly tougher ones, but for the last few seconds, let's look at the authority.